Okay, ladies and gentlemen, we are ready to convene our next hearing for the day. So if folks talking in the back could either take seats or, you know, step outside. We'd appreciate it. So we're just about to begin. So if people could take seats or maybe step outside, we'd appreciate it. We still have a couple of senators and perhaps witnesses getting to their places, but I think we will go ahead and convene this hearing of the Standing Committee on Housing, Construction, and Community Development. This is a public hearing on rent regulation and tenant protection legislation. This is our fourth hearing on this topic. I would note that we have one additional hearing in Greenburgh on Tuesday, the 28th, from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. at Greenburgh Town Hall. But today we're very happy to be here in Newburgh. Given that we are beginning substantially later than our scheduled time, let me begin by thanking all of those who got here on time and have been very patient waiting for a prior hearing to conclude. And I would also suggest that perhaps my colleagues and I will forego any extensive opening remarks, but I will first acknowledge that we have with us Senator Breslin, Senator Salazar, Senator Myrie, Senator Mayer, Senator Metzger, and Senator Skoufis has just stepped out, but will be because he was participating in the prior hearing, but he will be joining us very shortly. I will, I guess, give my colleagues the opportunity to say any urgent opening remarks if they choose. Okay, thank you all. So our first witness then is Assemblymember Jonathan Jacobson, and welcome and thank you for welcoming us here to Newburgh as well.
Thank you. Thank you, Senator, and thank you for having these important hearings on rent regulation and tenant protection. And I think it's notable you're having it that goes later in the day so that people that have to work or pick up their kids from school are able to come later, and I appreciate that. As with many areas of the law, there needs to be a balancing act. There needs to be a balance between the needs of the tenants and the need to encourage proper development. In the city of Newburgh, there is a need to protect tenants and also a need to encourage development for more better housing. I have committed to support these bills to protect tenants, and I've signed on to them. It's important to protect good tenants who have paid rent for years, particularly seniors, and would have no place to go if they are evicted. We have that a lot in Newburgh. They're fearful because there just isn't a lot of housing. This is why it's important that we make sure we encourage more housing, because if there was more better housing, it would change the situation, because those landlords that are not putting their apartments up to code would have a reason to, because they would have competition to rent out their places. So we have to think of both as we go along. But we need that protection. We need to make sure. I thought the proposed good cause bill has taken into account most concerns that people had in the past, particularly when an owner wanted to use the premises for him or herself or their family. The one section which is being changed, I hear, concerns a section which defines what is considered an unconscionable rent increase. The current language states that an unconscionable rent increase would be something greater than 1.5 times the rate of inflation, which for this year would be 3%. So if there was a rent of $750 a month, there would be only an increase of $22.50 or $30 on $1,000. It's probably unlikely that such a small increase would cover water, sewer charges, or tax increases. So I think that perhaps what would be better is to talk about unconscionable rent and list the factors that would be considered when determining that, because we want to make sure that when we go ahead to get new developers here in Newburgh and other in Poughkeepsie and other cities that really need it, they're not discouraged totally from stepping up to the plate. And like I said, we do need better housing so that the tenants here would not be forced to rent from some of the landlords you heard from earlier. So I think that that would really be helpful. Also, concerning the statewide rent control, and it's what I understand the bill to say, it's for buildings built in 1973 or earlier, I think we have to make it clear what happens when you have an old building from 1917 and it's been vacant for a lot of years, and now we finally get somebody to do something and they get a new CO in 2019. So that should be considered new construction and not part of it, but I think it should be clear in the statute so people know what they're getting into. But I just want to say I applaud the effort. This is difficult, but and I think that the fact that you're having these hearings is important because you have to explain what's going on with these bills. I do believe that the problem with tenants and rent is a statewide issue, and I'm sure you found that out as well. And I just think that when you balance it out so that we can encourage more development in cities like Newburgh, which has been getting some more development, not enough, that we can do both. I think we can protect tenants while encourage development, and I appreciate the opportunity to speak before you and congratulate you on your efforts.
Thank you. I'll just begin briefly, just a few comments. First of all, thank you again for your testimony. Thank you for your leadership in advocating for the many bills that we've been discussing. Just on the issue of good cause and its relation to the standard for unconscionability, I just to clarify for those that might be listening, I'm sure that you know this, that that changes in those in water and sewer charges and other things that are beyond the control of a given landlord would, of course, be acceptable reasons, even under unconscionability standard, to exceed the CPI, the standard that's in the current bill. But we will, we'll take that idea. We are having a extensive discussion among senators and certainly with the Assembly and the governor's office.
I heard it in our own conference, and I'm sure you've heard it in yours. The concerns, and it just we want to do it right. We don't want to. I don't think it's an either-or situation, and it's certainly not susceptible to bumper sticker solutions.
Right.
So,
and similarly on the issue of of buildings that have been abandoned for a long time under current standards, of course, if a building has been abandoned and is very substantially rehabilitated, also the rent regulation would not normally apply in those circumstances if the building is effectively a new housing that's being created out of a long abandoned building. But we have heard that concern, particularly in this area, and given all of the effort to redevelop formerly currently unoccupied housing, so that might be something we can consider clarifying. But we do very much appreciate your comments.
I appreciate. I have signed on the bills, but I just think that we have to work some things out.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, and I'm gonna. We appreciate the enthusiasm for this topic, and we had a little bit of applause, including from a lovely small child before, which was very sweet. We are going to ask that people just so that we can get through the questions and hear all your testimony, we're going to ask people not to react, too much to the to what you hear today, whether you like it or perhaps maybe you won't like some things we hear today. But we are going to try to get as many points of view out as we can today. So next up, we're going to have folks from the Kingston Tenants Union. We have Patsy Smith and Juanita Amador. And if there's anyone else from Kingston Tenants who is expecting to testify, if you could come up as well. So again, we're going to run basically 10 minutes for testimony. There is a clock there, and we will we'll remind you if you do have written documents you want to submit, we will accept those as part of the record of this hearing as well. We will ask people to respect that time so that everybody can get their turn. And in addition, then we'll have 5-minute periods for senators to ask questions of the panelists. So if you could begin, each person should begin, please, by stating your name for the record so that it's in the official recording of the hearing, and any affiliations you want us to know about, and then proceed with your testimony.
My name is Juanita Velasquez Amadon, and I am the founder of the Kingston's Tenant Union. These are two members here with me, Patsy and Betsy. And we are here due to the fact that Ulster County does not have any protections for their tenants. I've been fighting due to the fact that E&M Management came up here into Ulster County and took over. And I may not have any paperwork for you, but I have a lot of pictures for you. I lived in E&M properties where they came in, removed all our amenities, and raised our rents, and left us with no repairs. I lived in an apartment with sewage coming out of my tub for months, and they did nothing. I had bed bugs because the building had bed bugs. They did nothing. Okay, we had roaches because we had a sewer problem throughout the property, and everything that came out that sewer, everybody, all the tenants were feeling it. They have other properties where they are having gas leaks and people are being put out, and what they're doing is forcing them out. We had staff members who were harassing our tenants sexually as well as threatening, and I got tired, so I started speaking out. Ulster County needs tenant protections. We had over 210 evictions alone in Kingston in 1 year. That's almost one eviction every other day. And yet there's no place to house our homeless. We have over 1,500 just alone in Kingston, and that's not including the kids. Okay, we are 57% renters. Okay, and most of them are single moms, okay, with children that cannot afford to live on their own. And then when we go to ask for help, we're treated like we're less than nothing. That is wrong. And our own buildings department do not help us. You go and you speak to them, and they say, well, the landlord's gonna evict you anyway, so there's no use for me to go there. I have one housing inspector that said, well, those people, just let me know. I'll get them out of the apartment. Yeah. I'll find violations. And her name is Jeannie Edwards. Okay, that is not okay. I'm sorry, due to this administration that has been in this White House, people of color have been treated less than human. Protections are what we need, and we need you all to stand up for us. To be homeless, do I look homeless to you? Do you think I've ever been homeless? Yeah, I was. Because I was illegally evicted out of the E&M property when I fought back and refused to live in those conditions. So they found a loophole to get me out. So I was homeless, and thanks to my community, I didn't even get my security deposit back. That's another thing that happens here, upstate New York. Now, no one gets their security deposit back. So how are you supposed to move on if you can't get your security deposit back to put down on the apartment that you're about to get? I tried with the Common Council and our Mayor Noble. I've given him policies, procedures, security deposit law that could be passed just within our county that can help, even if we don't get universal rent control, which we want. Mm-hmm. But if we don't, there's some protections that you can put in place for us to make us there so that we can have something. It's really sad that we have all these tenants and children who are being displaced and not even going to their same schools anymore. It's sad. I mean, I remember back in my time, we didn't have tenant protections. And I saw my cousins, my family fight for tenant protections back in the 60s. I remember being burnt out of my apartment because back then you were able to be burned out and it was legal. They just burned down the building and you were done, you're out. We need just cause evictions. We need universal rent control. We need our security deposit bags. We need you to please stand up for the people. We are what we call the working class poor. Just because we make less than $50,000 does not mean that we are less than, okay? In actuality, those people that they call those people are actually who built America, okay? Because the rich would not have their money if it wasn't for the backs of the people that actually were building the railroads or building the roads. Or working in Walmart or stewards, and we don't even have the minimum wage up here. We're still getting paid $11.75 an hour. How is anyone supposed to live in an apartment at $11.75 an hour when you don't even make that much in your apartment? It's $1,000 a month, and that's only for a single apartment. It's horrific. I just ask that, I will show you the pictures if you would like. I want to show you what people are living in right now to this day with what they're living with. Because I think this is not right. It's totally not right. This is my apartment. This is what I was living in. And they thought it was okay. I know Kevin Cahill says he's a silent sign on for just cause evictions. Well, I went to his office to speak with him and got assaulted by his own staff. His receptionist assaulted me. I got video of it. Okay, and he still didn't come out to speak to me. A silent partner is not what we need. We need someone to actually stand up and take a stand. Because without yous who we put in office, we ain't gonna make it. That's about more what I have. I'm just asking, we need universal rent control. We need tenant protections. And I'll pass this on. And this is another founder here, Rashida Tyler of the Kingston Tenant Union.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. My name is Rashida Tyler. I am a co-founder of the Kingston Tenants Union, and I am on the State Board of Citizen Action of New York. I would like to thank the Senate for holding the series of housing hearings across New York State to allow those who are directly impacted by the current housing crisis to tell you their stories and their experiences. I am an advocate, and I carry the stories of many tenants who are struggling to afford ever-increasing rents and those who have been made homeless by unrestrained market forces here in the Hudson Valley. I'll skip everything about our organization's identification, and I'll be submitting my written testimony. But the Kingston Tenants Union is basically meant to educate tenants on rights, provide workshops and provide rides to court and social services, as well as assistance in housing search, direct assistance. Citizen Action is an advocacy organization, and we do not provide direct assistance. So I support the passage of all 9 tenant protection bills that are currently before the Senate and the Assembly. Ending geographic restrictions of the Emergency Tenant Protection Act would allow municipalities right outside of the 8 counties already included in the legislation to opt in to rent stabilization the chance to do so. The City of Kingston's Common Council has passed a memorializing resolution in support of expanding the ETPA and legislation enjoining the Village of New Paltz, cities of Hudson and Newburgh. Good cause eviction legislation will help to provide residents of the Hudson Valley with peace of mind when they speak up against landlords that refuse to make repairs. Since 2002, evictions in the city of Kingston have increased by 57%. You can be assured that they are not all for non-payment or property damage. We have found that when tenants become problematic, landlords will ignore repairs until they become a safety hazard, at which time they will call the building inspector and have their own premises condemned. This is a common end run around the formal eviction process, which silences many tenants from reporting needed repairs. It is increasingly becoming more difficult to find a place to live, and this is compounded for anyone with an eviction. In Kingston, there is a tenant database run by Kingston Landlord Support that tracks evictions based on data from courts and the Sheriff's Department. This has helped lead to tenant blacklisting. Also, landlords are increasingly requesting deposits of first and last month's rent in addition to security deposits to move in. However, there are also increasingly associated costs with just applying to get a rental, including application fees, background checks, and credit checks. In the Hudson Valley, we are facing a real housing crisis. The 2018 Ulster County Rental Housing Survey found a vacancy rate of non-subsidized apartments was just 3.16%. While anything under 5% is considered an emergency, this statistic gets even worse when we consider the city of Kingston, where the vacancy rate was just 0.5%. Our communities are in crisis. I hear about the struggle to find available affordable housing on a daily basis. This morning, in fact. It is taking longer to find permanent housing for the homeless. Families are doubling up, causing dangerous overcrowding, and people are working two and even three jobs to afford a roof over their heads. This leaves less money for families to spend on other basic necessities such as food and medical care. It is also preventing families from saving money to purchase homes for college education, and in the long run, it can really limit social mobility. Many families facing crisis cannot qualify for public assistance. The 2016 Asset Limited Income Constrained But Employed, Alice from the United Way, factors that there are 11% of families in Ulster County that live in poverty as defined by the federal poverty line of $11,880 for individuals and $24,300 for family of four. However, 30% of households are classified as Alice, meaning that they are above the federal poverty line but below the basic cost of living for the county. In order to just survive in Ulster County, an individual needs to earn at least $12.06 per hour, or $24,108 per year. And a family of four would need to earn at least $39.96 an hour. Wages are just not keeping pace with housing. Additionally, short-term rentals such as Airbnb are placing stresses on an already constrained housing market. The Hudson Valley is a top destination for Airbnb users, with over 300,000 guests helping hosts earn $50,000 in supplemental income in 2018 alone. In Ulster County, there are almost 150,000 guests bringing in $24.4 million. There is no doubt that people want to vacation and recreate in the Hudson Valley and Catskills, which can increase local revenues, but at what price? According to the American Community Survey and 2018 Ulster County Rental Housing Survey, over 50% of households in Ulster County are rent burdened, meaning that they pay over 30% of their monthly house incomes for housing. Almost 30% of the residents are considered severely rent burdened, meaning that they pay over 50% of their monthly incomes for housing. Ulster County ranks sixth out of 62 counties in New York State for the highest percentage of household income used to pay rent. This is not a statistic that anyone should be proud of. And so each of these statistics is someone's story. Carla, who was evicted from her apartment, she and her family rented in Kingston for 7 years, but after her landlord sold the building, she was evicted. Carla works hard to provide for herself and her two children while caring for her elderly parents, one of whom is also disabled. Currently, they all reside in a motel in the suburb of Kingston, which requires a car to access the supports that she needs for her family and her emotionally traumatized son. Mitch, who like Carla is currently homeless, is suffering a series of health setbacks, including a stroke that left him unable to work. After being released from the hospital, he was sent to the Department of Social Services for housing. From there, he was released to the warming center to recover from his stroke. Due to a 120-day sanction from DSS, he was unable to access a local shelter and was sent to the warming center, which was only open when temperatures dropped below 32 degrees. The center is closed between 9 a.m. and 7 p.m. The Kingston Tenants Union advocated for Mitch and was able to get a sanction lifted, and he was placed in temporary accommodations in a motel in Highland, which is located 16 miles from Kingston. However, his physical therapy and his doctors are all located in Kingston. Mitch has been given $446 to find new accommodations. Christine is a single mother of five children who works two jobs to make ends meet. She is doing her best to afford the three-bedroom home she has rented for the past 2 years. One of her jobs is at a fast food restaurant chain. Some weeks they cut her hours, so some weeks she can even have no hours at all. One of her jobs also just fired her to replace her with their niece. Her landlord began changing the terms on her rental agreement, making her pay for heating oil, even though this was supposed to be included in rent. She agreed because she and her family had nowhere else to go. The house needs repairs, and she tries to do as many as she can, but she cannot really afford to bring them to the attention of the landlord. She cannot afford to make trouble. Christine pays $1,500 per month in rent. I have lived in upstate New York since I was 5 years old, and I have seen it through good times and bad, like in my hometown when IBM closed in 1994, and many of my classmates suddenly had to move. Businesses closed down and homes sat vacant for years. Past dependency on large corporations helped to create this problem. Today, when I speak to many elected officials in upstate, I hear echoes of the same failed strategy offered up to explain why rent protections cannot be extended to their districts. While it's great to speculate about the impact of rental laws on developers, corporations, and investors that have yet to break ground in our community, there are people right here, right now, who are suffering and can benefit from the relief this legislation would provide. Thank you very much for considering these bills.
Thank you.
Okay, I'd like to introduce Betsy Kratt,
a member of the Kingston Tenants Union.
Senators, guests, fellow tenants, and activists. My Facebook status from May 19th, 2017 reads, I need your support. I'm facing eviction. My landlords have been entering my apartment and taking pictures without my knowledge or consent. I have legal representation, but no new place to live, and I'm so scared. I feel helpless. That would be the second eviction for me that year. My evictions, like many, aren't included in the official eviction count because we leave before the sheriff shows up. In 2015, my landlord died suddenly and without a will. Her estate passed to her children, and because they were minors, to their guardian, her ex-husband, who had no interest in being a landlord. But in 2016, I had my choice of two apartments and chose one in the Rondout. It was a dump. And there were fleas, and the circuit breaker popped if you tried to make toast while the bathroom light was on, and the pilot light in the stove wasn't lit, and there was one heat source for the whole apartment. My landlord, Fatima Dean, told me the building was for sale, but there hadn't been any showings in months. That was the first lie. A week after we moved in, we came home to find a notice on the door. A showing had been scheduled for the following day at 12 noon. I'd moved in on Sunday, and on Monday, the kids had to go to school and I had to go to work. Our mattresses were on the floor, disassembled furniture was leaning against walls, and all manner of stuff was scattered everywhere. Papers, clothes, cans of soup, you name it. In the morning, I called my landlord to say the apartment was a mess and we were not ready for a showing. "We understand," she said. "Everyone knows you just moved in. Don't worry about it." Second lie. The next week, I needed Ms. Dean to sign paperwork for the Department of Social Services. She kept asking to come by to see me. Finally, when she called, she told me the people who'd looked at the house had made an offer and she'd accepted it. The new owners wanted to live in my apartment. Third lie. The realtor, Barbara Viter, had called Ms. Dean, who went to the apartment and looked in the window. We know she went in. to see the mess I'd told her about. The house was not sold, but she was throwing me out, and she could because I had no lease. She was disgusted with me and said she wouldn't want me as a tenant now anyway. She said she'd give me a reference, but she never called any landlord back. Fourth lie. I begged her, but it was no use. I was served with eviction papers and given a move-out date. My security deposit, I learned this from landlords, by the way, that you are not getting it back. So that last month of rent, you're not getting that either. They taught me that. I proceeded on I'm gonna take good care of your stuff, you know, so you're gonna give me back my security deposit. Doesn't happen. So through friends, I found another apartment with some creatives from Brooklyn and moved in there. And then I started noticing itchy bumps on my arms and legs. I asked my landlord, do cockroaches bite? Because we had a cockroach problem. And no, he said, but bed bugs do. And that was how that nightmare started. And I bagged and dragged every item, sock, shoe, dishcloth, pillowcase, dust ruffle, mitten, down two flights of stairs and spent 9 hours at the laundromat. Not for the first time. I would do that several times over the coming months. My parents gave me the money to buy the required mattress covers because I didn't have the $125. At the time, I was what HUD calls severely rent burdened. I was paying more than half of my income in rent. And the meager bit of money I saved to take kids for pizza or a trip to Goodwill went towards laundry. My landlord didn't really want to be bothered letting in exterminators, so he gave them a key. And because they had a key, they could come whenever they wanted. And because they could come whenever they wanted, they didn't give me notice, which means I couldn't do the prep. I don't think these exterminators are very good, I said to my landlord. If I were you, Betsy, I'd look at myself before I cast aspersions on others, was his reply. And for nearly a year, I lived in that apartment with our clothes and towels and bags piled up in the kitchen. Well, of course, after the term of the spraying was up, my landlord didn't believe they came as often as they did, and there was no way for him to prove it or disprove it because he hadn't been there. So my legal advocate told me I could stop paying rent and look for a new place to live. And now it was 2017, and it was a whole different ballgame. There were no $1,000 two-bedroom apartments anymore. They were $1,200, they were $1,400. And you weren't looking at apartments, it was an audition. But I'm a broke single mom with two kids, and I'm not the tenant that anybody wants. And I couldn't tell anyone why I was moving, because now I had a landlord who was disgusted with me, a dead landlord, and now a bed bug infestation. I dragged my kids with me in the hope somebody might think they're cute. And every dump I took them to see, no matter how frayed, damp, dirty, smelly, they would see possibilities. They would go, wow, and cool, with excitement, and they would be charming. And one day my son Dennis asked me, did we get the apartment? No, sweetie. I said, we didn't. And his twin brother Conan asked me, why does God hate us? And we were served. My boys missed the first process server, but they were home for the second one. Now they were scared, and they went to stay with their dad while I waged war against the bed bugs who turned my hair white. Now I live in Section 8 housing in Hunter, nearly an hour drive from our lives. Our children's, my children's schools, my support networks, my parents, my children's father, and it's only possible because I have a car. And you know, that's not something that you can take for granted, like not everybody has one. But without that, I'd be in another terrible situation with a terrible landlord. And this is my experience as a tenant in New York State. In Ulster County, you can apply for Section 8 when they open the waiting list, which is once every 2 or 3 years. If your name is drawn in that lottery, you get a place on the waiting list. You don't get a Section 8 voucher. And I've been on that waiting list for 3 years. Every subsidized housing development in Ulster County maintains a waiting list. RUPCO, which is the agency that administers those grants, those vouchers, they have buildings. They have one that's LEED certified and has gardens. They've got one that's a loft. They've converted for artists. But there's no designated development for just poor working stiffs, single mothers and their kids. And I've been on those waiting lists longer than the Section 8 waiting lists. The waiting list is so long that caseworkers told me that they don't tell people about it anymore. Landlords lie to us, they steal from us, and they prey on us because they can. We're garbage to them. We are the most vulnerable citizens, the poor, the disabled, the elderly, single moms and their kids. The wolves are at our door. I shouldn't have to leave this county. I've lived here for 40 years. I was born in Kingston. We need universal rent control, and we need protection from frivolous evictions. I've always been proud to be a New Yorker, and especially proud to be from New York State, from upstate New York. Aren't we better than this? Don't upstate tenants deserve the same protections afforded to our downstate counterparts? To quote George Bailey, this rabble you're talking about, they do most of the working and paying and living and dying in this community. And is it too much to have them work and pay and live and die in a couple of decent rooms and a bath? I ask you, is it?
Thank you.
And now we have Patsy Smith from the Kingston Tenant Union. She's one of our new members, and we also have pictures of her place as well.
Hi, I'm Patsy Smith. I've never done anything like this before, so pardon me. I've only ever done things in church. So I'm bold in there, and I'm shaking like a leaf here. But I believe all things do happen for a reason, and since this happened to me, I believe it's my take to stand up for those who are too scared to speak up themselves, because as I speak to other people in Black Creek, where I am from, under A&M management, every person almost has the same response, is that they're scared of getting the famous three-day eviction and they can't afford to be put out. And they're afraid of being bullied and they're afraid of being strong-armed. I didn't think, you know, people could act in such a manner, but obviously they can. I've had things said to me, and obviously they talk about situations that are going on that is not my fault. And maintenance guys that usually talk to me and smile and, you know, have conversations with and check on me are now turning their backs on me, making sly remarks towards me, knowing that I can't get to them fast enough to speak to them direct. But when I very first pulled up to Black Creek, all I could think of was this place looks so nice, especially for the price. And it was advertised for $11.75 a month for the beautiful black and white kitchen that they advertised all over the place. Everybody had a waiting list to get in this place. And I needed a place desperately. So, you know, having a little girl, I needed to put a roof over her head. And I thought this place was beautiful, you know. And I should have followed my gut feeling that I had, that it was kind of shady. I went there three times, driving 30 minutes, being told I could see the apartment. And finally, at last, I said, do not invite me to the property until you can show me the apartment when the tenants are moved out. We get to the apartment, and she opens the door, and we walk in, and there's some things lying around. So I thought that was kind of odd. I said, I thought the tenants were moved out. I look to the right, and there's a man laying in his bed sleeping. And I was petrified of getting arrested for breaking and entering with this woman, because I didn't know this woman. I shoved her. I ran out as fast as I could. And I called my husband scared to death. I was like, I don't think the man seen me, but I don't know. I seriously don't know what to do. Things go on. I go back. I made sure there was nobody in there. And it went from $11.75, and she knew that we really needed a place. Then it was $12.10 a month all of a sudden. And then it was an $1,800 deposit that we thought was only going to be $800. And then $100 a piece for us to get background checks. And like I said, we were desperate, so we did it. And a couple of days later, I had told her that I was leaving town. My daughter, I had to travel 4 hours for her health care, here nor there, but she knew that it was the most important appointment we had been waiting for since birth, and she calls me up and says that she's missing $1,000 of my money that I paid her with, you know, this, where it's the one, like a money order where you have the stub. And I said, I handed it to you. We laid it all out and counted it together. It was in your possession. That's not my fault. And she said, so when are you bringing me the $1,000? And I said, you know, that's not happening. That's your problem. Well, I have that on video of her calling me back the next day laughing about it, saying, I found the $1,000. It was on the floor in your hallway. I'm a very vigilant person. I know my surroundings. I'm very well aware. And I said, no, it wasn't. You're lying. I don't know what your incentive was or what you're trying to do, but, you know, that was wrong of you to do to us. I came home, and I do not move into a place unless I Lysol and bleach it. I have, like, clean and OCD problems. I walked in. There's big, fat, greasy hands gliding up my hallway, and I'm pretty sure it was done on purpose to intimidate me. And they even went into my refrigerator. I'm pretty sure they were looking for the stub of the $1,000 that I told her wasn't not my problem, because she had kept asking for the stub of the $1,000. But I had hided that into a special place, and I have it to this day, just in case if anything should arise that they're missing $1,000. And I've also been informed that I'm not getting my $1,800 back, or quote unquote, I am seriously not giving you a dime back. I paid my rent 3 days early the entire year. I keep a very clean home. There's not even a scuff on the paint, but they're angry because of their lack of negligence, their negligence. So, like I said, we was lied about everything. Carpet shampoo, we'll give you new blinds. The lights never had caps on them. The windows didn't open. The oven was completely filthy and full of cleaner. I almost put a chicken dinner in there to cook until thankfully I seen that there was chemicals in there. I could have poisoned my family, that she assured me that was cleaned, which I think is pretty low. So the roof started leaking when the rain came, and it seemed like a domino effect. It went from one leak, and me and my husband to this day joke and say they should hand out buckets with their leasing, because there are so many leaks in my apartment, it's unbelievable. And it's a shame that I have to scold my daughter to either stay in her bedroom or come out to the living room, because I don't want my daughter walking underneath a current fall that continually falls down. It's not just drip every minute, it's continually falling across the whole top of her doorpost. And that's not a good feeling as a mother when you have to tell your child you can't play in your own home. On top of my dining room table is completely busted open and pours down. I have a video of water pouring out of my light fixture. And when you call and you nicely and say, you know, these leaks are happening, can you send somebody out to fix them? It's never addressed. They don't want to give names of who's in charge, who's the big guy. They don't want to comply with you. They call you on block numbers. I had to find out the property manager's name through another tenant, and he calls you block two. I'm going to skip a lot of this. We was told to just call them if we didn't want to sign lease March 20th, and that they would schedule the walkthrough to come through to get us our deposit. We called Annette, the secretary of the property manager, and we was told, I don't handle that. Mike deals with that. So I said, can I please get Mike's number? I don't give Mike's number. Nobody has Mike's number. Like I said, I found out his name through another tenant. They're like Secret Service, I guess. So you try to even see them on the property, and they get in their car and they leave as fast as they can. I complained for 10 months about a banister and a railing also. My daughter has a prosthetic leg, and I have an autoimmune disorder. So I have to carry my child up 4 flights of steps. I need these codes. That's my main problem, is building staying up to code. When you can't get out to your fire escape, when your windows don't open, when you have exposed wires and hallways for over 2 months and nobody's working on them, that's things that I have problems with. When you're scared to death of walking up the steps with your daughter and you don't know that you can't hold on to a rail because it's not secure, that's scary when you have to do that, especially as a diabetic when you're not feeling well and you're in charge of a little life in your arms, you know, and you have to beg them, and they don't call you back, they don't comply with you, they don't fix anything. It took me calling a building inspector to come out, because now I've had enough and I just don't care. And I told him to put my name on the building inspector. That's when they finally wanted to address the lack of the fire detectors. None of them worked, none of them was hooked up, and there was only one, and there's supposed to be one in every room. And my husband had fell in April. There was no lights in the hallway. I called for a month every 2 days, and what I get told from E&M management is, don't worry about it, it'll be fixed. The shared meter is being addressed as we speak. I call Central Hudson, they say they've been calling, they've been writing, there's no answer from them, there's no compliance there, and they're not returning phone calls, they haven't reached out to them, and then the lights go out. And then guess what? My husband's walking in, and you know, he literally, like, if this is the step, his foot was here. So naturally you would put your hand on a banister, correct? The banister that's on top of like a wall here, he put his hand on it and it flipped up like this, hitting him, knocking him down. I told them, I'm not trying to be nasty, but I think we at least deserve medical. I was told it's completely against protocol and it is against the law, which I have all of that on video also, to give you our insurance information. Insurance claims do not talk to tenants. Insurance claim will not reach out to you at all. Like I said, I only have a seventh grade education, but anytime I got in an accident, insurance claims ask you, was you texting? Did you have your seatbelt on? So, but after I called the building inspector, miraculously, an insurance claim agent called my husband and says, I've been trying to get your information for over a month now. And my husband said, just out of curiosity, when did you get my phone number? And he said, an hour ago. And that's about when the building inspector, you know, had sent the report that with my name on it that I wanted on there. There's 6 violations in my apartment alone, and there's also exposed wires in every building for over 2 months. They're not working on them. That's the codes need to be assessed. I shouldn't have to complain when I'm paying you. I'm not living there for free. And I don't think that any of us should have to take it that far for somebody to do what they're already supposed to do. That is right.
Thank you all. We'll just take, I'll defer to other members of the panel first. Anybody want to? Senator Metzger, you want to begin?
I just want to thank you for your testimony. I don't represent Kingston, but I feel like I represent Kingston. I'm right next door and in Rosendale, and incredibly aware of what's happening there in terms of housing, and gentrification, which is putting such a huge pressure on affordable housing in Kingston. But to hear the firsthand accounts of these kinds of practices, these kinds of entirely unacceptable practices, is so important. So I appreciate you being here, and I want to just thank you for your testimony.
Do you know that E&M management is about to come to Rosendale? So hello, you'll be with us. You're about to buy a property there.
Also, the effects and gentrification are not only in Kingston. We're using Kingston as an example, but when people are pushed out of the city center, they're moving to the suburbs. They're moving to places where the forces of gentrification are, there's a ripple effect. And so this is going to impact rural communities, whether people think that or not. And then people who have a higher demand for services are being pushed out into rural areas that don't have these services. The rate of poverty is going to increase. And so this is something that's going to impact all of us.
Senator Mayer.
Well, I just want to thank you, and I also want to give you credit for forming the tenants union, because that's obviously been a source of power that you wouldn't have had otherwise. And while we're going to work on legislative solutions that address non-New York City, I represent Westchester, where we have rent stabilization, but above Westchester, where, in my opinion, we need rent protections, and I think you'll find we agree with you. Thank you for your testimony. Thank you for keep the tenants union going, whatever happens. You know, the power is in numbers.
Thank you, Senator Mayer. Senator Salazar.
Thank you. First, I just want to thank all four of you for your testimony. Thank you for your courage as well, Patsy. And I find it remarkable how patient your daughter has been, truly. So thank you. I found it interesting that both Betsy and Patsy, that you both mentioned RUPCO. We have a representative from RUPCO on the witness list, and I look forward to talking to them about some of the things you mentioned in your testimony. Juanita, I wanted to ask you, and thank you for sharing your story. I've heard from some of my colleagues, particularly with regard to expanding
tenant protections to those who currently have virtually none outside of the ETPA region. By giving tenants rights in the eviction process, we will flood the courts. I'm naturally not sympathetic to this, but regardless, feel that it warrants a response. As somebody who has gone through the eviction process and to court, could you just walk us through, if you don't mind, what that process was like for you as a tenant without having passed this legislation?
Sure. I had no rights. When I went to complain about a landlord, we don't have a tenant-landlord court. It's only a landlord court. They told me if I wanted anything to be done, I had to sue him myself. And when I got the eviction notice, I went to see a judge to try to get a stay. And there was no judge for me. And I stood at that courthouse. And I said, someone has to see me so that they can hear my case. And they said no. And I stood there until they made a phone call. I said, I don't care who you get, the magistrate, I don't care who it is, somebody. It took an entire day just to get a judge to sign my stay, then to overturn it due to the fact that when I first went to court and I asked legal aid to please let them know the reason why I'm fighting was because I had no repairs, it was not mentioned to the judge. So it wasn't put in writing. So the judge says, I'm not going to see your evidence. You're evicted immediately. And I was. So there was nothing for me. No matter where I went to try to get the help, there was none. I couldn't, no judge, nobody to speak to. So for a tenant to try to fight their eviction, it was hard. And I went through the whole process. Like I said, you went to the courthouse, no one there to see you. It's only on a Tuesday, and usually the landlords, when they go to put an eviction notice, they immediately get to see someone. So they'll get that, and then they'll get the eviction notice, and then they'll go put it on your apartment. But for a tenant to go in, there is nothing at all. We have nothing. And if you go to the buildings, they go and tell the landlord, and then you get an eviction notice immediately, and it's in retaliation for you speaking out. Uh-huh. And then the building says, well, there's nothing I can do. And that's another thing that happens as well. They go and look at you, and they don't even give a fine. I actually have a court order that they were supposed to take my landlords to court, and they never did. They were supposed to remedy the problem back in August of 2018, and never to, I got evicted a week ago. They never took those landlords to court. There's a failure some in this process here, and we need the help.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Skoufis.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thanks to each of you for your testimony. You know, a lot of these issues we've been debating for now some time, and it's helpful to be able to put faces to that public policy, right? And so I am grateful for your being here, and to Senator Mayer's points, I think it's both impressive and quite frankly essential by the sounds of it that you have this tenants union in Kingston. And so I encourage you to keep doing that as well. My one question, one item that that is new to me in terms of hearing it from advocates and even sort of institutionally, we haven't really discussed this, at least in those places where I've been part of the conversation, is this issue of security deposits. And so, you know, leases that I've seen, typically at the end of the lease, there's something, you know, okay, this is the dollar amount that's a security deposit. Sometimes it's, you know, first and last month, sometimes 1 month, whatever it is. And then there's, you know, some sentence or a couple sentences, you know, you'll get the security deposit back at the conclusion of the lease, as long as, you know, or minus like any damages or whatever, right? And so, you know, under what authority do these landlords have, in the couple of cases that have, that has been brought up to withhold returning that security deposit. And so look, I guess, you know, anyone can sort of willfully not follow the lease, right? But then don't you have sort of legal recourse? Can't you hire a lawyer and say, you know?
I could have gone to a small claims court. That was you know, with the first landlord, I didn't even include this. He told me, well, there's no, because, you know, this was the ex-husband of my landlord who died. Said, well, there's no record of your security deposit. And I said, well, it'll be held in escrow. You should be able to find it. You know, and once I said that, he didn't fight me and he gave me my money back. But every other, you know, I could have taken her to court, but, you know, I don't even know what to say. Like, the two of the other people who are responsible for Kingston Tenants Union are property owners. And I think that that's great because, when you're trying to survive, like you're, you only have, like, I have a child with autism, you know, I have their limited hours in a day. So I just thought, screw it. You know, so she kept my money. You know, I did live there for most of a month, whatever, you know, even though she threw me out. You know, I just didn't have it in me to fight, you know, because so much of being poor is fighting, and you have to prioritize what you have the hours, you know, the strength for, and I just didn't have it that time.
Again, in Ulster County, well, up in Kingston, actually, and I've known in Ellenville and a couple of other places, what happens is they tell you if you want your security deposit back, you need to go sue your landlord. Yep. That is the answer we get in court. They don't even discuss it at eviction time. They go, you want your security deposit? Go sue them. Half these people don't have the money to go pay $45. So we have to sue them to get security. We have no laws to protect us on that as well. New Paul's passed a security deposit law that we're trying to bring to Kingston, that we've been trying to get legislation and our officials and our locals to come on board with that. At least that gives something to the tenant. I mean, that's what we're trying to work on.
I think also that there's a culture in upstate New York, particularly Ulster County, where I can speak to, where there's a certain class of people who get evicted, and the people who are landlords and judges and lawyers in court, they know they're not going to bring a lawsuit, a civil suit, to get that security deposit back. So it's a culture where it's you're out of luck. You're better off living the last month, not paying the rent, and you know, having the landlord keep the security deposit, because you know that's what they're going to do anyway. I think that we do need a law that definitely is enforceable, and that landlords have to return a security deposit within a defined amount of time. We know that there's a law that says 28 days or something like that, but that doesn't happen in reality. So we need something a little bit that's going to compel landlords to comply.
There's also an article that is under the Real Deal that was written by, oh my God, it's going too slow.
It's still loading.
Yeah. It's written by Georgina
Comrie.
If you had a chance to read it, you actually hear the response of these landlords on how they can take advantage of us because we're upstate New York and there's no rules.
Yep.
And you'll even hear a sheriff department, from the sheriff's department, the one in charge of evictions, he's also quoted in here, and not in a very good way. So if you get a chance to read that article, it'll tell you what's going on in Kingston in upstate New York, and it's pretty accurate.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We just have a maybe quick follow-up by reminding people that we're a couple hours late, but Senator Metzger.
No, I was just going to say that this kind of points to a different problem, even with the good cause bill. If you don't have the resources, the legal resources to go to court, you know, so I think that that's another issue that needs to be looked at quite apart from this legislation.
Thank you. And Senator Salazar, one more?
No, it's okay.
Okay. And I so
Sorry, I just...
30 seconds.
30 seconds. When you speak to RUPCO, something that I'm really interested in that we haven't been able to get an answer about is when the Section 8 voucher is issued, whether it's used or not, it's counted towards the allotment, you know? So when Alex, one of the other founders of Kings and Tenants Union, asked the executive director of RUPCO, well, so you go next down the list, right? Like, you know how many of them are being used, right? And the answer was, no, we don't know how many are being used. So I've foiled Section 8 records since 2013, and I'm waiting for that. That was on May 15th. But I'm curious as to what records they keep, and if they find somebody that's not using the voucher, why do they not go down the list? Because there are I think he said there are 200 families on the waiting list for Section 8 vouchers in Ulster County.
Okay, again, we really appreciate your testimony and your patience today. Thank you all. And for one or two of you who said you weren't used to this, you were very, very helpful to this panel. So thank you, we really appreciate it. So next up, we're gonna hear a variety of perspectives today. Next, we are gonna have Nick Page, who's a member of the Dutchess County Legislature, and also I think representing progressive legislators from other localities as well. And then, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Nick Page, member of the Dutchess County Legislature representing Beacon and Fishkill. Thanks for giving our area a convenient opportunity to be heard on these issues. It's great. Today I'm going to read a statement on behalf of the local elected officials network, Local Progress New York, and specifically on behalf of Francina Amparo, my colleague on the Dutchess Legislature representing the town of Wappinger, and a member of the Local Progress New York Organizing Committee, and Chad Raddick, who's the New York State Coordinator of Local Progress. The statement is as follows. Our network, Local Progress New York, we are a network of local elected officials across New York State, united by our commitment to shared prosperity, equal justice under law, livable and sustainable communities, and good government that serves the public interest. Building a more just and equitable society requires an engaged citizenry, strong institutions, and elected leaders who are dedicated to advancing the progressive movement. We commit ourselves to this work in partnership with community leaders and progressive organizations around the state because we share a belief that by organizing together, we can build a more just and equitable society. Our membership has approximately 200 local elected officials statewide representing cities, towns, villages, counties, school boards, and more from Niagara Falls to Southampton and from Binghamton to Plattsburgh. Local Progress members meet each year at a state convening. At our last event, we held a discussion about affordable housing in New York State. As it had been an issue our members felt needed more exploration by the network. This year, our organizing committee, our governance body for the New York chapter of Local Progress, decided that members should work together to protect renters across the Empire State. Resolutions across New York. Local Progress members from New Paltz, Hudson, Newburgh, and Beacon passed local resolutions supporting the expansion of the ETPA and the Good Cause Eviction Bill. Similar legislation is proposed in Westchester County, Ithaca, Syracuse, Rochester, Kingston, and Albany, and Local Progress members are ready to take leading roles. In all of these areas, renters represent between 45 to 75% of the residents. Many of these communities are also under a 5% housing vacancy rate and by state law are considered to be experiencing a housing crisis. If the ETPA were extended outside of the 8 counties that have currently been authorized by the state legislature, all of these areas would be able to allow their local officials to make a decision as to whether to opt into the ETPA and help to stabilize rent costs for thousands of upstate families. Rents are rising in our communities faster than wages, and displacement of residents is a concern of many Local Progress members. In all of the areas that have passed or are considering passing resolutions of support, 45 to 60% of renters are facing unaffordable rents, defined as rents, again, that are more than 30% of a family's income. So this is a crisis not only among those in the Metro New York City area, but to upstate renters as well. Renters are more than 60% of the residents in Albany, Kingston, Newburgh, Plattsburgh, Poughkeepsie, Rochester, Syracuse, Troy, and Wappinger Falls. And in these areas, renters paying more than 30% of their monthly income in rent range from 65 to 45% in Albany, Kingston, Plattsburgh, Syracuse, and Troy to 60% and above of renters in the communities of Newburgh, right here, Poughkeepsie, Rochester, and Wappinger Falls. The rent burden issue is even worse when you disaggregate the data and explore how rent burdens grow among renters of color in the Empire State. In a recent report by the Fiscal Policy Institute, renters of color are disproportionately rent burdened compared to white households. According to the report, only 37% of white renter families are rent burdened statewide, compared to 46% of African Americans, 53% of Latinx, and 52% of Asian and other families. Another issue that is brought into focus by the housing crisis in New York State is the staggering number of low-income renters, for example, a family of three with an income at or below $40,000 a year, who are paying more than the 30% threshold of their incomes towards rent. The federal government is determining that that 30% threshold, paying above that, is unsustainable for any household, yet in New York State, 42% of low-income renters are paying more than one-half of their incomes in rent, and almost 4 out of 5 low-income renter families are paying more than 30% of their incomes of rent. Availability of affordable housing. According to a report we are co-authoring with the Community Service Society of New York, available affordable units have fallen in the state by 10% from 2012 to 2017, with big percentage losses of affordable units in Suffolk County and in the Hudson Valley. In 2012, rents up to $924 a month were considered affordable for a family of three making $40,000 a year. And for the same demographic in 2017, affordability was determined to be $988. The state of renter protection in New York State. Renters without leases living in month-to-month rentals have no right in New York State to remain in their homes. Even renters with leases have found that it is easier for the landlord to evict than to hold the property owner accountable for conditions within the unit. Many Local Progress members have shared stories about constituents who have been forced out of their homes in the Hudson Valley, the Capital Region, and in Rochester due to the lack of rights for tenants in New York. Because people of color are more apt to be in low-income households, not only do they pay a higher percentage of their monthly incomes for rent, but they often live in housing that is not of the highest quality. For example, recently at a renter town hall that was held in Wappingers, one renter in Wappingers Falls described finding her unit infested with mold that ruined her wardrobe, her furniture, and other possessions. She had to involve the county health department and then needed to find new housing because her housing was declared unsafe. Legislative proposals before the state legislature. Local Progress supports all 9 of the bills on the Upstate Downstate Housing Alliance's legislative platform. The two bills to most importance to areas north of New York City are the Expanding the Emergency Tenant Protection Act of 1974 to encompass the entire state, and the Good Cause Eviction Bill. Expanding the ETPA to cover all communities within the state affords local control to our municipalities and counties over their rental apartments. Throughout the state, thousands of units could be stabilized, thereby creating a secure permanent home for good tenants. In all of the communities listed above, again, Albany, Kingston, Newburgh, Plattsburgh, Poughkeepsie, Rochester, Syracuse, Troy, and Wappinger Falls, the vacancy rate is below 5%. This means that in all of the areas most hard hit by the statewide housing crisis, they would find relief with this proposal. The second bill that we're most interested in, the Good Cause Eviction Bill, would only allow landlords to evict tenants who have violated terms of their lease or have not paid rent or have caused damage to the property, while allowing renters the ability to hold landlords accountable for building conditions. In addition, the rent would stop unconscionable rent hikes. Currently, if a landlord insists, an upstate renter has no recourse but to move out of a situation if they're unable to field a major rent increase, or if the landlord is asking for a more reasonable rent increase, but also requiring that the tenant bear the cost of maintaining the functionality and living conditions of the property. We ask you to support these bills. Thank you.
Appreciate it. Thank you very much for your testimony and your colleagues throughout. You know, we've had meetings with Local Progress before, and we really appreciate all of your work. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
So next up, we are trying to accommodate many people's schedules, and we know people have been here for a while. I'm going to ask Carla Johnson to come up. And then I know we have some additional people from CVH that we're going to do a little bit later, but we're just trying to accommodate a couple of people who need to leave for family obligations.
Hello. My name is Carla Johnson. A city of Newburgh resident since 2012. a CVH member for the past year and a half now. I had moved to Newburgh in 2012 from New York City. I moved here for a change, a difference. Living here in the city of Newburgh, I have moved 9 times due to the fact that when you make complaints to your about the landlord to codes enforcement, you are immediately given, well, in some cases, you're given a 30-day notice and then a 3-day notice, or just the landlord may say you have to go. My first 2 apartments I was evicted out of. By the 3rd one, I got smart. When I say I got smart, it was I would take the landlord to court, because in the city of Newburgh, since there's no tenant protection, if the landlord brings you to court, you automatically evicted, even if you don't owe any rent money. So in my case, I have a 4-year-old who haven't been living in an apartment for a whole year. She moved 4 times and she's 4. We finally got good housing, which has a possibility of lead, which you may hear me coughing throughout the whole day is because of my asthma. The reason why good course is good for the city of Newburgh is because it gives young children a stable home, a stable place to live. We're forced out of our apartments and put in shelters. I lived in a shelter with my daughter for 1 night because living there was just horrible. And the city is a wonderful city. The city of Newburgh is a great city, minus all of the abandoned buildings and different things that's going on. It's a beautiful upcoming city, and it's a great city. And I would like to thank Jonathan Jacobson for signing all 9 bills for the good cause, because he sat on our city council and he heard numerous people complain about the poor conditions. And to piggyback earlier with the landlords that were up here, the landlords basically bully tenants. The landlords took the city of Newburgh to court, and once you take a person to court, you're the winner, even though you may not be the winner. So I just feel that good cause is great, because I rented a building that was condemned, condemnation, rat infestation. And when I moved in the property, I heard one of the landlords say, like, yeah, when you go in an apartment, you look for all of these things. You make sure it's working hot water. You make sure there's heat. You make sure, you even move the stove out to make sure it ain't no holes so the rodents wouldn't run around. And I want to go to codes enforcement. The problem with, I believe that we have is a lack of code enforcers here. Why I say that, I believe that is because they do go, once a tenant makes a report against the landlord, say you have mold, say you have bed bugs, whatever the problem is, and you bring it to a higher authority as the code enforcement, they go and they inspect the apartment and they write the violation. Once the violation is written, the landlord then puts you out. So if you have mold, for instance, if you have mold and you complain to codes and they come out, they write the violation, the landlord then retaliates against you, and then they smack the cheap paint up on the walls and move another tenant in. So once the new tenant is in there, the case is basically closed for the codes, because it's no one to investigate. Like, Carla, did they fix the problem? Oh, I don't live there anymore. So I think that the reason why we need the good cause is because it secures homes for children. It secures a foundation for someone. I spent $46,000 since 2012 to slumlords here in the city of Newburgh. Not every landlord is a bad landlord, but the majority of the landlords are horrible. And it's like, you give them, they want cash. Some landlords want cash money. I gave them $2,000 to a landlord outside for a condemned condemnation. And when I went to Kohl's, I went and did like a FOIA request because now I'm interested about what's going on with the building. The landlord owes the city of Newburgh over $250,000 in fines. So I just think that if your building is not up to codes, you shouldn't get anything. The tenant should put maybe their money in the escrow account until the landlord is up to date on codes. And I think that the codes shouldn't give landlords these rental licenses if they have more than one or two violations, because I could say, Senator Skoufis, I'm gonna fix the problem, just give me the rental license. And it's not necessarily that I fixed the problem, but I have the rental license. And that's where the ball gets dropped at. We need more code enforcement. We need more code officers to follow up. And Chief Horton is doing an outstanding job. I did a petition on our last codes person, Steve Hunter. And he was later told that, you know, he's gonna retire, and Chief Horton stepped up and he's doing a great job. But the main fact is it's a whole statewide. It's a statewide thing. It's 9 bills that need to be signed. Some say, oh, they've signed 4 or 5 of them, and a lot of stuff doesn't apply to the city of Newburgh, but it's a statewide thing far as tenants being protected all around the board. I believe that my child is 4 years old and she hasn't been in an apartment for a whole year. And that's not fair to her. Like 1 minute, oh, we live at 93, you teach them one address and then you have to teach them another address. So I just feel that we need good cause and we need to crack down on these landlords who's taking advantage of us. I moved here from New York City. I worked for the Parks Department for security for 15 years. And I want to buy a home here in the city of Newburgh, but at the moment, I can't afford the high taxes, so I'm have to rent. And so when you renting something, I shouldn't have to rent a rat infestation apartment. I shouldn't have to rent a mold infestation. I should be able to rent a beautiful apartment when my landlord, they live out in Marlborough and they got the fancy cars and the big houses and they live in high on the people here in the city of Newburgh, and some of people live like savages here. I want to be honest with you. There's so many people that comes to our community voices heard, and it makes you want to cry. And the reason why they don't say anything is because they're afraid of the retaliation. The retaliation here in the city of Newburgh is if you go to Kohl's, you getting out. So I wanted to know if you guys, if you haven't done it already, if you could just pass the good cause here for us, because you don't know how many people you're gonna help. And with the good cause, it's not gonna not make landlords wanna invest here, make people invest here. It's just protecting the tenants who is really the important people here. So that's all I wanted to say. And again, thank you for having this hearing, and you guys have a good day.
Thank you very much, and thank you again for your patience as well. So next up we are going to have Michelle McKeon of RUPCO.
My name is Michelle McKeon, and I am the Chief Operating Officer of the Regional Economic Community Action Program. Since 1965, RECAP has been the state-designated anti-poverty program for Orange County. We serve seniors, veterans, victims of domestic violence, individuals living with HIV and AIDS, people with substance use disorder, and anyone living below the poverty line. Our programming includes Head Start, workforce development like the Fresh Start and Mill Street Cafes, parole reentry, residential and non-residential treatment facilities for drug and alcohol, nutrition and advocacy, and of course, housing. In 2018, we were awarded 40 units of the Empire State Supportive Housing Initiative housing for victims of domestic violence and or substance use disorder. 20 units are slated for the city of Newburgh, and 20 units are slated for the city of Newburgh. There are a few things to note. According to the New York State Community Action Association, New York State has a poverty rate of 15.1%, with women-headed households living in poverty at 37.4%. Orange County's poverty rate is 12.6%, with 31.8% households with women-headed households with children living in it at that rate. When we look at our two biggest cities, 17.3% and 32.2% poverty rate for Middletown and Newburgh, respectively, the women-headed household rate with children present is 50.6% and 55.6%, respectively. If you imagine for a moment those numbers and the people, the children behind those numbers, we should all be horrified, or at least curious as to why they are living in poverty. While county employment is low, employment in livable wage jobs is still elusive in this county. Livable wage jobs in the city are almost non-existent, and where jobs are offered for better pay and, importantly, with benefits, transportation and childcare is at best challenging and at worst non-existent. Both cities are also food deserts, with healthy nutritional foods difficult to come by. And it is very safe to say that food pantries and soup kitchen outnumber by double digits grocery stores. And the food pantries locally do consistent business briskly, monthly, repeatedly. Our cities in particular Newburgh, struggle with environmental concerns, including the poisoning of our water, lead and asbestos in buildings, and crumbling infrastructure. All of the aforementioned determine the health of a community, the health of a city. They are the social determinants of health. And one I have yet to mention is housing. We are beyond a housing crisis. We must look at New York City, but we must look beyond the borders of the Bronx and Westchester into our suburbs all the way upstate. This is not just a New York City problem. When I worked in Albany as the CEO of the New York State Coalition Against Domestic Violence, we talked about New York City and rest of state. To make sure we don't leave those people behind, we must make sure that rent regulations and tenant protections expand beyond New York City. This homeless housing crisis is far-reaching and having devastating effects on communities. Housing is health. Housing is healthcare. Safe, affordable housing improves the lives of individuals, families, neighbors, community, and beyond. We can no longer operate not in my backyard. Our 20-unit program in the city of Middletown has been told by the mayor there is no way he is having more affordable housing being built in the city of Middletown, and we have to return that money to the state because we cannot get approval to build in the city of Middletown. We don't have the luxury of the kind of time to wait for other people to start paying attention. Every night in my county, people sleep outside, and as someone who led a point-in-time count this year, none of you, nor me, would ever want to sleep in some of the places we visited where people actually sleep every night. We visit abandoned houses where there are 600 abandoned houses in the city of Newburgh, with boarded-up windows broken into with mattresses, food, unsafe lighting, and unsafe heating equipment, and padlocks on bedroom doors to keep people safe. We spoke with people who were just wandering the streets looking for a warm spot in the biting cold. It was 28 degrees that night. We gave out hats, food, scarves, socks, and information, and tried to engage people in the process of finding housing. None of this is easy. Add mental health, substance use, domestic violence, trauma, and poverty, and it's overwhelming to access the help offered. And let's face it, our systems are not exactly user-friendly. Safe, affordable housing is a right. While in Orange County we have low-income housing, it is not enough, and if there is real confusion about the different types of housing. There is low-income housing, there is affordable housing, and there is market-rate housing. We have some amazing organizations doing some good work. We provide permanent housing. RUPCO's phase two is moving along. Habitat is doing their work. But to be honest, the people that we serve at RECAP can't afford RUPCO's apartments. They cannot afford houses from Habitat. We work with people who get a $412 housing allowance from the Department of Social Services. Think about your own rents and mortgages and where you could possibly access housing, safe, affordable, clean housing for $412. That's why our ESSEs are so important, especially for families and singles. We are so thankful for that grant, but that grant does not come with capital funding. So we have a grant to provide case management and subsidize housing units for permanent housing, and no money without another grant to build the actual housing. It is two steps forward and one step standing in place. We have to do better. We must do better, and we are imploring you to help us do better. We must make it less cumbersome to meet the needs of our neighbors and our communities. Housing must be safe and affordable. Safe means without the hazards of lead and working utilities, windows, doors, and staircases. We allow people to rent apartments without those things. While the county and cities do their best to enforce the laws, there are still people living in absolutely horrendous conditions. Furthermore, the city of Newburgh tenants are fined for dirty apartments, and when that law, which was pushed by the landlords, was originally designed, there was also a 10 or 15 day jail sentence that came with that and a $250 fine. And who determines what's dirty? Because half the time my house looks like who did it and ran. I wouldn't want somebody coming in and judging how clean my house was. In the city of Middletown, landlords are now required to do a criminal background check before they rent to somebody. That scares our tenants and the people that we work with that they're not going to be able to find housing. All of these legislative fixes can and have a chilling effects on the most vulnerable and fragile. Rent protection and good cause eviction, that must be part of any package. We don't want people evicted just because they're complaining about the conditions they're living in and it happens on a regular basis. We must acknowledge that tenants are in non-power positions in many cases. We have seen numerous cases of tenants making fair and legitimate complaints about living conditions and being retaliated against landlord, either by raising rents, locking them out, refusing to sign a lease, or just evicting them. This harassment by landlords who are not doing the right thing must be stopped. Rent control, rent regulations beyond New York City is paramount to protect both tenants and landlords. We recognize landlords also have challenges, that at times tenants can be destructive and wallet draining. We especially see our small business landlords, where the cost of repair and maintenance can be fiscally problematic. But working together, agreeing that safe, clean living conditions benefit everyone, tenants, landlords, lawmakers, we can make real progress ensuring that tenants are protected, landlords are able to run successful businesses, and communities are healthier and safer. Housing is key. Safe, affordable housing is the key. If we make a true commitment to one another and to our neighbors and be our neighbors' keepers, then we can provide healthier communities for all of us. And isn't that what we all want? Isn't that what we are required to do? And isn't that what we should want to do? Thank you so much for having the hearing.
Thank you. Any questions for this witness? Okay, thank you very much. Next up, we're gonna have Albert Annunciata of the Building and Realty Institute of Westchester. Are you missing?
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and the committee for holding this hearing. Again, my name is Albert Annunciata, Executive Director of the Westchester Building and Realty Institute. We are a membership organization of over 500 members running the gamut in the building industry. We represent, regarding the rental industry, we represent 120 building owners in Westchester County. Primarily small to middle-sized building owners, probably 90% of them don't have buildings above 40 or 50 units. We're not talking New York City class. And not surprisingly, they are concentrated in the major cities, Yonkers, of course, Mount Vernon, New Rochelle, White Plains, and the town of Greenburgh, which I understand you'll be having another hearing next week. The town of Greenburgh also has several major apartment buildings as well, mostly clustered in the urban centers. I do have handouts, which I will, I think I have enough for everybody on the committee, but you know, I've been listening very carefully to the very heartfelt and sincere comments of the tenants up here in Orange County in the Newburgh area, and it kind of ties in, just as an observer and a listener, it ties in directly to the very dramatic testimony that was here at an earlier committee meeting, I guess it was Joint Housing and Investigations, where you had the experts from FASD, the Firemen's Association, and they were talking about the importance of enforcement of building codes. There is a municipality in Westchester County, I don't want to mention the name because they're currently undergoing a big to-do over their housing situation, but some of you might know which one it is. But for the past two or three years, they've had hearings like this about housing conditions. Many of the housing conditions are like the ones that we heard here from the other speakers, where it was the conditions of the housing, dangerous, substandard, fire detectors, alarm detectors, and CO detectors that didn't work, the very things you heard from the FASD experts. And they happen to have, this municipality happened to have, a volunteer landlord-tenant advisory board, which operated fully and completely within the limits of the village. And most of the cases that that they had to deal with were not rent level, you know, the levels of the rent. The average rent in Westchester County is still below the HUD, you know, designated fair market rent for Westchester County. So it wasn't so much the rent level, it was the very dangerous and substandard work living conditions that would bespeak of a failure of that municipality through their building inspector and fire inspector to make sure that these conditions did not persist or even exist for that matter. So you have that situation where of all the things that was wrong with the rental housing in this particular village, the rent levels were like 9th or 10th on the list, because there are areas, even in Westchester County, that simply don't command the high rent levels that you might find in Scarsdale or Chappaqua or even New York City. So, you know, so I was kind of listening to the interrelated, system that has been discussed and how there are a lot of stakeholders in this process. You know, all of us, we talk to our legislators, our assembly reps, our Senate reps, and some of us even make the trek to Albany and do the same thing up in Albany. And I couldn't help but notice the New York State seal, and my knowledge of American history and state history, such as it is that you have Columbia on the left, representing the new world and the energy and the power of the new world, and you have Lady Justice on the right with the sword and the scales of justice. And I've often thought about that in relation to the whole rent laws issue. And then of course you're up in Albany and you're running around like a chicken with your head cut off, and then you see this, you know, the state of justice in New York State, and here's Lady Liberty Justice with the scales. Now just imagine the existing system of rent regulation. Now I can only speak for Westchester County, which along with Rockland and Nassau County are under ETPA, the suburban form of the rent stabilization law in New York City. So in fact, Westchester probably is the largest of the three. They have the lion's share of the units under ETPA, Nassau a distant second, and Rockland even a far more distant, like the planet Pluto from the sun, you know, the least amount of ETPA housing. But if you looked at this, at the system, at the regulatory framework in which ETPA you know, operates, and you look at the scale of justice, and you have, you know, the two, if I may, being a frustrated teacher, having the two scales the two plates of the scale of justice on either side. This is what exists now, and you know, in the grand scheme of things, quite rightly so, but this is what exists now. The tenants are on this side and the owners are on this side. So if I may use, with the generosity of the armory and their supply of cups, we have senior citizen rent exemption. Senior citizens can apply. This is a very active and popular program in New York State. You have senior citizens rent exemption so that any rent increases that might come along, whether from a legitimate MCI, major capital improvement, or individual apartment improvement, or even the smaller increases that invariably come from the local county rent guidelines board, senior citizens are exempt from those increases. Then you have DRE, the disabled rent increase exemptions, and quite understandably so. There's no income qualification for rent protection under ETPA. And I heard the last witness talking about landlords who, you know, are quite wealthy and they've got a place in Florida or the Hamptons and they drive fancy cars. Well, I can tell you that, you know, if any of you asked DHCR for, one of my senators left earlier, if Senator Mayer asked DHCR a pointed question, how many units in Westchester County are under ETPA? DHCR would not be able to give her an exact figure, okay? Because they're dependent on the information they get from the municipalities who have ETPA, and also those who do respond, those landlords who do respond every year to providing the gobs of information, financial and otherwise, with the operation and maintenance cost surveys, the apartment registrations. So there's a tremendous amount of information coming from owners in Westchester, but DHCR still doesn't know exactly how many units. We've estimated, based on our membership, accounting for about 15,000 of the units in Westchester, we've estimated that there's probably between 20 and 25,000 units remaining in Westchester County under ETPA. So going back to, there's no income, real income test for being eligible for all the benefits of rent stabilization, rent regulation. Tenants up to 200,000 are protected. Now, only if DHCR initiates an investigation, anything above 200,000 for a period of, I think it's two consecutive years, and again at DHCR's initiative, then they can proceed to say, hey, you've got to free up that unit for someone far more worthy, many of the people here in this audience, far more worthy to deserve the protections of rent stabilization. We've estimated that a minimum of probably 20-25%, maybe 4 to 5 of that 25,000, 4 to 5,000 units in Westchester County are being occupied by very, very wealthy tenants. Are there wealthy landlords? Absolutely. But for every unit that a wealthy tenant occupies in Westchester County or anywhere in the ETPA system, that is one unit denied a eligible, struggling, middle class, lower middle class, poor family in need of rent protection. So keep that in mind. There are a lot of inequities in the system already. And again, inequities, I'm kind of pointing out the scales of justice here with the two plates on either side. Continuing on the tenant side, we're subject to, the owners are subject to, in any of the counties, including New York City, rent increases from the Rent Guidelines Board. Invariably, because it is an eminently political process, that the increases are very low, almost, many times zero increases, because it's political. And by the way, tenants can serve on the County Rent Guidelines Board and vote on their own increases
Mr. Nunziata, I'm going to ask you to wrap up, and I think you will have questions.
But a lot of people had time. I just wanted to present. I'm not finished. I'll probably have another 5 minutes.
We're as I said at the beginning, we're offering each witness 10 minutes for initial testimony, and we have been holding people to that, and we also...
I should have brought maybe somebody else to continue the talk then, I guess.
Well, we consider each...
Very quickly,
One testimony is a principle here that we've been adhering to, so we'd appreciate if you'd wrap it up. And you will have additional
I just couldn't help noticing the amount of time that was given to the other speakers.
Was 10 minutes.
Very quickly, pro-tenant members on the Rent Guidelines Board, there's a tenant protection unit that does the work over from the DHCR. We have succession rights where families can be in the same apartment for years and generations. Permanent rental assistance, Section 8 and others become a permanent part of the lease, and so forth. So you've got all of this, and the only tools remaining in the owner's toolbox are basically three or four things. Major capital improvements when needed, individual apartment improvements, vacancy allowance, and of course the flexibility of preferential rent when the market does not command the legal regulated rent. So I present this to you for your consideration. There's a lot of inequity in the system. I would ask you to keep both sides in mind, because this is the side that actually keeps the old housing stock. The average age in Westchester County is approaching 100 years, because a lot of these buildings were built in the 1920s and 30s. So I do have handouts for the committee.
We'll take any written material and incorporate it into the record.
This goes into a little bit more detail of the importance of these last four tools in the remaining toolbox of building owners.
Okay. Thank you very much. Do senators have questions or comments? All right, I'm going to start at my right and work our way across. Senator Salazar.
Thank you for your testimony and for the cup demonstration. I wanted to ask, you mentioned legitimate MCIs, and I realize that you were contrasting that with increases that aren't actually through the Major Capital Improvements Program. But I was reminded by your use of that language, you seem to, I guess my question is, do you think that most of the increases granted through the Major Capital Improvements Program are legitimate rent increases? And do you think that there is a problem with fraud in the program, for example?
It was tough enough for owners to get an MCI with all the documentation and receipts and everything that they had to do. Now with the tenant protection unit that I think has been around now for 3 years, and I think that was specifically addressed by the governor, the creation of the tenant protection unit, they've actually gone back and to MCIs that were approved and gone back and checked and rechecked. So, it's a pretty hard gauntlet for the owner to go through with all the documentation, so that the MCIs are legitimate. The MCIs, they have to be to be granted the okay from the Division of Housing. But MCIs, and some of that is the age of the building, and some of that is regulatory. In Westchester County, and I think in New York City too, the number 6 oil is being phased out, number 4 oil soon, and then either they have to convert to number 2 or gas. So you're talking about massive old heating systems in these buildings that have to be redone, either converted to gas, but we have a Con Ed moratorium that we have to deal with in Westchester County, and I hear on the grapevine soon to be on Long Island. So you've got a regulatory component to MCIs, you have to do them, but also you have the age of the building and the condition of the building, whatever. So the MCIs, they're not at every building at every time, but on an as-needed basis or for compliance with regulatory directives. And it runs a gauntlet through DHCR and through the tenant protection unit.
Sure. So I'm pretty familiar with the MCI program. The reason that I asked is because our understanding, based on a lot of testimony, not only from tenants, from legal experts,
from even the agencies. It seems that there actually is a lack of oversight in the MCI program, and that actually a lot of the increases through the program are not really verified, and there's a lack of accountability. I just want to clarify, you're from the Building and Realty Institute of Westchester?
Right, we're a trade association, much like a Chamber of Commerce.
Sure.
My 10-second elevator speech is when somebody asks me what the Building and Realty Institute is, I say, do you know what a Chamber of Commerce is? They go, yeah. We're the Chamber of Commerce for the building industry. So we represent about 120 really small to mid-sized building owners in Westchester, among the other real estate classes of membership.
Right, because my understanding is that there are about 1,500 members in the institute, but not necessarily property owners.
Overall, yeah. Actually, the apartment owners are one of our smaller groups, but we also have a number of, not surprisingly, in any organization like this, a lot of contractors, suppliers, service firms. We represent several hundred co-ops and condos in Westchester who also face the MCI, the need for capital improvements, whatever, so they're familiar with that, obviously under a different regulatory umbrella. So it's about 1,500 all told, yes. Different classes, but the apartment owners, just about 120, representing about 15,000 of an estimated 25,000 units in Westchester County.
Got it. And do you happen to know if E&M Management is a member? E&M.
Oh, E&M. I wouldn't. We have a huge database, and I'm old school. I took over in 2001, where my predecessor, who ran the association from 1946 to 2001, I was looking at DOS computers and fax machines. I still like fax machines. So I'm not a tech person. I actually avoid our database. I leave it up to others in the office. But EMN, I can find that out for
Great.
You.
Thank you. I appreciate that. The only other question I have, because you mentioned the tenant protection unit that has existed for a few years, do you know how many full-time staff the TPU currently has?
No, I just know that it was created several years ago by the governor, I guess carving it out of regular DHCR. And when we met with, I'm not telling tales out of turn, Senator Mayer will tell you this is exactly what happened. When a group of us met with her at her offices, and she was very generous with her time for about an hour with our group in Rye, she asked the question, I've asked DHCR, have they done any investigation, TPU, have they done any TPU investigations in Westchester? And they told her no. And then two of my owner members, both women, we have more than several women and minority-owned building owners. They said, well, you have two people in this room who were checked, double-checked, triple-checked by TPU over our MCI applications, and they had all the documentation. They gave it all back. What they gave to DHCR, they provided, again, to TPU and even in more detail, whatever, and everything was okay. I wouldn't necessarily know how many are in the TPU. That would have to be something that maybe one of you good people could possibly find out from DHCR.
Yeah, so right now we did in the state budget increase the allocation so that they could specifically hire 94 full-time staff, but currently there are 25 staff members in the tenant protection unit, and it's just remarkable to me when I hear your testimony that TPU is this resource to so many tenants across the state and to two of your members in Westchester County, because it's actually what I've certainly found and what tenants have attested to, as well as legal aid attorneys, TPU is not the resources that they've had, even that they'll have now, is not adequate to cover the entire ETPA region.
I can well understand your point. It's a big region under both rent stabilization and ETPA as it is, without even thinking about, the need statewide or even, commenting on that. But I only mentioned it here because it's one of the things on the tenant side, however understaffed, that's certainly not here, you know, in terms of the benefit for the owner.
Thank you, Senator Sellers. Senator Myrie.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for your testimony. I want to focus on this notion of means testing. You mentioned that there are a whole body of folks that are missing out on the opportunity for affordable housing because they are not means tested. And this is not a novel concept. I think we've heard this in this discussion, that we should be looking at the tenants and we should be means testing the tenants. I want to talk for a moment about means testing property owners. Because if we are, and I do have a question at the end of this, if we look at the rent regulated system, certainly in the city of New York, according to the Rent Guidelines Board, only 5% of property owners were distressed, meaning that they made less money than the building was giving them, right? So we have heard the argument from property owners that the reason that we need to keep some of these regulations in place, MCIs, IAIs, and these other means of passing on the cost to the tenants, is because that's the only way that the property owner will be able to make money. That is the only way that they'll be able to keep the building moving. But only 5% of them are not making money. So here we are instituting a system in which 95% of the property owners are doing okay, if not doing very well, but we are calibrating and passing on the cost to the tenants. And so should we be determining our policies based on how well the landlords are doing?
That's a good question. With the years that I've been an observer, I'm not an owner myself, but with the years that I've been an observer at the County Rent Guidelines Board, the operation and maintenance cost surveys and the apartment registrations and all the information that the owner has to file every year with the Division of Housing, one can determine as a group profit margin, how well they're doing as a group, how not well they're doing or whatever. So, you know, there's already a lot of data on the owner's side for policymakers to look at and you know, look at how well off the owners are. In a way, owners are like an electric utility or any kind of utility where they're providing a public service. They privately own the building.
I agree, and that is precisely why they should be regulated.
And the thing is, and they are regulated, but the thing is, just like Con Ed, maybe there should be, just like with rent control, many of you might not know this because it was a surprise to me to find out that there are still maybe a few thousand of the old World War II rent control units in throughout the whole system, New York City and the suburbs. And DHCR determines the percentage increase of rent internally based on CPI or whatever. So that's like the Public Service Commission saying, okay, Con Ed, you get X percent increase this year, and that's passed along to the users. So whereas the rent control units get 9% in some years from DHCR, the Rent Guidelines Board with ETPA gives them 0 or 1% increases. So it's kind of like there are disparities all over the place. But certainly there are inequities on both sides that we are looking to all of you, especially in such a position of power and responsibility, and also opportunity to look at the entire rent law system and, you know, come up with reasonable and rational regulations across the board for both tenants and landlords.
So I'm sorry, just for clarity's sake, and I appreciate your response. I think we are well aware of, and we're trying to fix, in fact, that disparity between rent control and rent. But you do not agree that landlords should be means tested.
I think it's certainly within the power of all of you legislators on both houses that, you know, there's a tremendous amount of information already as to the health or the lack thereof or the middling condition of building owners in New York City and in the suburbs. And So, you know, certainly, you know, it's something you should look at if you feel you should. But, you know, with all the talk of affordable housing, and I come from a family of renters in Mount, I grew up in Mount Vernon, New York, and I grew up long before ETPA, I'm sorry to say. I grew up in the 50s and 60s, and my parents were immigrants from Italy, that, you know, we struggled and whatever, didn't have the protections that exist today. But suffice it to say that when you talk about affordable housing, whether it's Westchester County or Orange County, whatever, to have 20% of the units out there in the hands of people who happen to be in the right place at the right time for generations because of the succession laws, that it doesn't matter how much they earn or grow in salary every year, that they're in place until somebody decides, well, there's a suspicion that tenant X in apartment 2B is earning over $200,000, so maybe we should take a look at that particular unit. For every unit like that, it does cry out for a certain amount of social justice that in the American way, that person earning a high income should really move on and give, salute, and give, see, that's the Italian in me, and give a more worthy tenant, single mom, low to middle class person, a chance for a rent stabilized apartment, which really they need and really is due them.
So thank you, Senator Myrie. Just briefly, since you know we are very late, I would suggest some of those cups. We appreciate the cup demonstration. A couple of them I might move over, just for example, by pointing out that statutorily these rent guidelines board do have to have two landlord representatives and two tenant representatives.
That's correct.
And then five additional. So I'm not sure, you know, how that generated a cup for the tenant side without
Westchester
a cup for the landlord side.
I can only speak for Westchester. In Westchester County and in the ETPA statute, a tenant can serve on their on the rent guidelines vote and vote on their own increases, decreases, freezes. A landlord cannot serve.
I believe a landlord can serve as long as they are not owning. A landlord can serve as a public member as long as they are not an owner of real estate that is actually regulated by the statutes. But
right,
there are certainly many landlords and many who are sympathetic to the interests of landlords.
Right. They're not under the regulatory aegis.
Again, I would say that, you know, the idea that it's not balanced, it may, you know, is something that certainly many would question. And I also would note that the high income deregulation provisions are that is a process that landlords can initiate. What many people are concerned about is that under the current process, it doesn't just remove the undeserving household that makes $200,000. Although some, you know, in some of our neighborhoods, you know, $200,000 might be like a, you know, a school principal and a firefighter, a two-income household. But also, you know, it removes the unit entirely from rent regulation. So, you know, there's no provision right now to remove that high-income household and keep the system in regulation.
And that's part of the inequities right. That you all are looking at.
But we do appreciate your testimony and your cups.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much.
My wife is a fourth grade teacher in Yonkers, and either she'd be very proud of me at this moment, or she'd be absolutely horrified.
She can. This will be webcast, so perhaps she can view the tape and let you know.
Oh my goodness! All right.
All right.
Thank you so much.
Okay. Next up, we're going to have. Again, we're very happy to have some of our elected officials, some of these things we're discussing today might empower them going forward. But I'm going to ask Ramona Monteverde to come up along with Anthony Grease and also. And Tammy Hollins as well, who I believe is not an elected official but is joining this panel. Thanks.
So first, I want to thank everyone for having this hearing. I greatly appreciate it. It is a critical time here for us, especially in the city of Newburgh. I did not prepare any statement, so I do apologize for that.
Record, thank you.
So my name is Councilman Anthony Grice for the city of Newburgh.
And I am Councilwoman Ramona Monteverde, Ward 2.
And I am Tammy Hollins, a resident here in the city of Newburgh.
And so, as I was saying, I am very fortunate to live in a house, and I do consider it fortunate. When I talk to the people in the city of Newburgh, one of the things that strikes me is the amount that they're paying in rent. I pay $900 for my mortgage, which includes my taxes. And many people were paying way more than that, sometimes almost twice as much as that, for conditions that I wouldn't put my dog in. They are horrible conditions. And then the situation in the city of Newburgh is when they do go complaining to our codes department or some other entity, what is happening is they are then quickly sent out of their house, out of their apartment, and then it's a scramble for them to find places to live. For sure, not all of our landlords are slumlords, but a majority of them do have serious code violations on their buildings. A lot of our buildings in the city of Newburgh were built in the early 1900s. I think about 60% of our buildings were built before the 1900s. And so they definitely do have some issues with them. They have lead, they have asbestos, they might have a leaky roof or some other situation that comes along with old houses. But when the landlords buy those properties, they do not buy them sight unseen. They are very, very aware of what is going to be in that building and what it incurs, and they are definitely making a profit on that. And so we do need all nine of those bills signed, even though some of them, what seems like it only affects New York City right now. There is going to be, especially in the city of Newburgh, as we're revitalizing, there might be the opportunity that we might have those same kind of housing units here in the city of Newburgh. So it's important that we pass all nine of them. The other thing that I wanted to mention is our codes department right now in the city of Newburgh, I believe we only have four staff members. That's not enough to sustain us. We really need to have about 15 to really do a great job with codes enforcement. One of the issues, though, is when we do go in for our codes enforcement and we tell the property owner that his building is condemned or whatever the case, and now we have just made a family homeless. And so then it puts us in a scramble of trying to find some place for them to go. And, you know, we as a city, we don't have those resources to say, you know, you're out of your place and now we're going to transport your whole family to some other place. I do work for the Newburgh and Lawrence City School District, and I work very closely with our homeless liaison, Mr. Morgan. And so when I know about a situation that's coming up, I'll call him to his cell phone, sometimes a late Saturday night, and say, you know, heads up, we have this family that's coming, and can we, under the McKinney-Vento law, can we ensure that at least the children have a smooth transition as far as getting to school and getting the meals and getting the meals on the weekends? But it still really puts us in a tough situation. And I heard how the other gentleman, how his time was cut short, so I'm going to yield my time and let.
Thank you for letting me speak. I actually came because I wanted to and I wanted to thank you for actually holding these hearings. It's extremely important in the city of Newburgh that we start to work on improving the housing stock. I have been working in the city of Newburgh since 2001. I actually have 26 years in affordable and supportive housing. I started out in Yonkers. And Yonkers is way ahead, and the work that we were doing with affordable housing in Westchester. And then I came to Orange County and actually was shocked to see that tenants are not protected here. There's no rent control regulations in the city of Newburgh. And today, as a councilwoman and working in supportive housing, I'm seeing that the housing condition is deplorable. We have 128 apartments where I work, supportive housing, low income, And that is not enough. 128 apartments, and we have a waiting list of probably about 500 people that are needing to get in at 30%. The housing stock in the city of Newburgh for a very long time, because we don't have the staff in the codes department to inspect these apartments and to stay on top of these landlords, is really, as my colleague here, Councilman Grice, mentioned, it's just, again, it's deplorable, and people should not be living in these apartments and paying rent. And unfortunately, what we're seeing in the city of Newburgh is the rents are going up, they're not affordable, people are being pushed out. At the same time, we are trying to hold the landlords accountable, but in doing that, we're condemning buildings and we're closing them down, and people are being homeless and displaced. So therefore, we need to build more affordable housing that is suitable. So thank you again for letting me speak. I will pass this on to my colleague, Tammy Hollins. Thanks.
Hi. Thank you. I want to bring light to another piece of the housing stock here in the city of Newburgh, and it's called the multifamily housing. And the multifamily housing is governed by HUD regulations. Senator Skoufis and constituents, since the new management personnel took over Varick Homes, which is a multifamily housing property funded by HUD, the residents and myself, I have been experiencing emotional stress, displacement leading to homelessness, and harassment because the policies and the procedures of the HUD handbook 4350.3 are not being followed. Working people, many of them at Varick Homes, cannot go to work and focus on our jobs or focus on their jobs because of the emotional stress of being harassed. We have seniors who are our most precious but fragile assets, who have worked all their lives and they didn't make a lot of money, but they did work. They are being worn out daily, mentally, emotionally, and physically, and are in fear for their livelihood, wondering where they're going to go because they're going to be homeless. What's even more astonishing is our seniors, they don't qualify to be evicted. Not when it comes to the regulations of the HUD handbook 4350.3. Senators, it's been bad, but now it's getting worse. It's like no one is monitoring, no one is watching. Newburgh is rebuilding, redeveloping from the fragility of the deterioration of poverty of the years past. Local and state officials and its administration has stated numerous times that we are not doing business as usual anymore. And New York State and in the city of Newburgh. But there are some businesses who are still set on doing business as usual. Senators, we cannot allow this if we plan to redevelop the city of Newburgh or New York State, because if so, it won't happen. Someone has to say something. Someone has to not be fearful enough to be quiet. Someone has to not be scared to come up and speak pertaining to our housing, and that's where I am, and that's why I'm here. Somebody has to speak up. Everybody can't be fearful. Everybody can't stay scared. We have to worry every day down in Varick Homes housing about coming home and finding a note in our door, a letter in our mailbox, a phone call coming in, or a message or a phone message that we need to come to the office for something or to do something that does not line up with the HUD regulations, again, of the HUD handbook 4350.3. So this evening, senators, I'm asking, Varick Holmes is asking, please, let's not give any more passes or power to the property owners who are defrauding HUD and the tenants, who are mismanaging the properties, and who are grossly negligent in the city of Newburgh anymore. Let's stand up together against the entrapment tactics that plague our city residents daily from the housing stock owners. Thank you.
Thank you. Any questions or comments from the panel? Senator Skoufis.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and it's a pleasure to see all three of you. And in my first 5 months, it's been a delight working with both of you council members and your colleagues. And I think that, you know, we've made some progress on a lot of issues. You know, I know specific to what we're talking about now, we're working together on funding a housing needs assessment, and there's a lot more work to do, and certainly we have an opportunity on this side of the table to bring some tenant protections to Newburgh that you all need, and that, more importantly, your constituents need, right? And Tammy, I know, you know, we've gotten to know each other a little bit over the past year or two, and there's a reason why you're the sergeant at arms of the Democratic Committee, right? And this is the first I'm hearing about what you just read, and offline, let's have a conversation right after you're all done with your testimony, and I'm willing to help whoever I possibly can. You and your neighbors, you shouldn't be harassed, you shouldn't be going through what you're going through as you described. So I will be happy to join you and your neighbors in fighting back wherever we can.
Yes.
But thank you for your testimony, and we've got a lot more work to do.
Yes, thank you.
I'll join you in thanking. Thank you for your testimony. Next up is Bob Bronklick still here from Kingston Tenants? Thank you for your patience. And next up, I'm glad to see, I think this, some of the CVH folks have returned. So we will have the rest of the CVH crew up for next. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Hey, everyone. I really appreciate you taking some time to listen to me today. I'm new to the Hudson Valley. I just moved back to New York from Texas 7 months ago. I was renting in Texas. I've lived in Rhode Island prior. I've rented there, Massachusetts, New Mexico, Cali for a little while. But in New York, where I'm from, I've never rented. And this is my first experience here, and I just wanted to share my story with everyone here so far. It's been interesting. When I first looked for my apartment and found the one that I have, the building I was shown had multiple issues with it. The front door was missing a literal 2 inches off the front of it. It was interesting that an apartment could be showed with a door that didn't have a complete bottom to it. The windows didn't stay up. There were no screens in there. There was black mold in the bathroom. The breaker panel seemed to have a hum to it, which I later discovered after plugging things into outlets in the apartment after I had signed the lease. The showing process was a very rushed process. It was done by a leasing agent who was contracted by the company that manages the property. And it was just a very rushed process, and I was promised during this process that all these issues would be fixed. My door would be completely replaced. There would be molding replaced. I would have things, the apartment would be put back in working order. Okay, I believed it. I signed the lease. I've signed many leases before. There really never were issues with the apartments that I've looked at in the past. They were all taken care of prior to, and any ones that did exist were taken care of as promised. But with this particular situation, after signing the lease, nothing was done. The apartment was left as is. I was continually told for the following 4 months, yeah, we'll fix your issues. Don't worry, we'll fix your issues. Just make sure you submit the issue through our online portal or get in touch with whoever the maintenance person was. And it, no matter how many requests I made, it just continued to stay in the state that it was. It was surprising to me that in New York State that a landlord could rent an apartment that was, one, in that condition, and two, just continue to seem to not really fix it after renting it. So anyways, fast forwards, I've been there for 7 months. I finally got my door replaced. That's pretty nice. The drafts went away a little bit. I guess I missed my front door mail slot, though, 2 inches off the bottom of the door, but that's not a big deal. And I've noticed some things since I've been living there. It's a 575-square-foot apartment. It's small. It has a fireplace in it, which is in a state of disrepair. It's not capped, and it also is missing the flue part, so it's just opened. I hear things fall through there occasionally, and if I'm, I guess, unlucky enough, I can see something fall through there. So that's just an interesting thing with it too. The doors, the windows, the bathroom with the black mold, the pipes freezing in the winter, and I'm not able to take showers or use my toilet. I mean, those are just common conveniences I think would be allowed to everyone who rents an apartment. Well, looking into it a little more, talking with my neighbors, my apartment, my 575 square foot apartment, cost me about $1,200 a month to rent. My neighbors who have apartments which are two times, three times the size of what I rent, they pay the same amount of money I do. That sort of struck me as odd. Why do I rent an apartment that costs me the same amount of money with much less space? And when I brought it up to the landlord, they just told me that all the units are unique and individual, and they have their own charm to them. And that's interesting. I didn't know black mold was a charming feature to an apartment. Also, along with this landlord, I've heard many stories from many people who live there, similar to mine, but also that deposits don't get returned. And I guess from talking to more people, this is a larger issue in New York State where there is a law for it, from what I understand, but landlords don't very commonly follow it. And I'm not aware of the route that needs to be taken to actually get your deposit back legally, if that becomes the case. But yeah, I've shared, I did print out an article and a copy of my lease agreement, which I shared with Senator Salazar. I apologize for not having more copies here, but anyways, I want to share my story, and I really appreciate you guys listening to this, and, you know, hope something comes of it.
Yeah. Thank you again for your testimony and for your patience. Any Absolutely. Questions or comments? Yeah. Okay, we really do appreciate it.
Thank you.
Okay, next up we have, this is handwritten here, but Patrick Cousins and Omari Shakur. And I have Cynthia Maria from CVH, but I don't think she's here. Okay, if the two of you could come up.
Omari Shakur, New Voters Movement, Community Voices Heard.
My name is Pat Cousins. I'm a resident and a landlord in Newburgh.
So basically why we're here today, we're here for tenants' protection, tenants' rights. We recently attended a protest up in Albany where we wanted to pass the 9 bills. We wanted to get that passed. So while we're here today, just to bring some information about the city of Newburgh, and one of the reasons why Newburgh has been like it has been, because code compliance, before Chief Horton has taken over in the last year, the landlords, they ran code compliance. So that's why we were having a whole bunch of problems in the city of Newburgh, because code compliance, they weren't enforcing the codes, because the landlords, basically, they ran code compliance. So we had, in fact, I know you heard all the problems that are happening in Kingston and stuff. The same stuff was happening in Newburgh, the mold in the buildings, stuff like that. But we just recently ran, I'd like to show you some pictures. We were passing out flyers the other day for people to come out here. And there was a, some people approached us. A landlord, somebody had just brought a building at 54 Johnson Street. They brought this building like 2 days, and whoever was in there, they had put them out. They put somebody else in there. They took all the stuff out and threw it on the ground. They told the new tenant not to come in the front door. She has a baby. She has to go through an alley and climb over a refrigerator to get in her house because this building hasn't been inspected or whatever. And he don't want nobody to know that he's renting it out already. So these are some of the problems that we're having, and we need tenant protection in the city of Newburgh. We need tenant protection because, like I said, you have houses that are full of mold, and people, as you see, there are not many tenants out here today because they're scared of retaliation. Soon as you complain, then the landlord comes to your house the next day and say you're being evicted. And I know I was somebody brought my house approximately a year ago, and they brought it on a Monday or Tuesday, I was being evicted. So there are no, most of 75% of our tenants in the city of Newburgh are renting without leases. They need leases because that'd be your first form of protection right there when you have a lease. So 75 to 80% of the renters in the city of Newburgh are renting without leases. They're renting month to month. So that's one of the reasons why there's no protection, because there's no leases in the city of Newburgh. So we have a bunch of problems right now, but this is a landlord, and he's a landlord, and he's an owner-occupied landlord. And that's what we want to see in the city, owner-occupied landlords, or we want to see some of these tenants. I lived in Newburgh seven generations deep. We have lived in Newburgh. When I was raised in Newburgh 60 years ago, most of the people in my community were homeowners. But after urban renewal came through, now most of the descendants of them homeowners are renters now. And we don't have no type of protection. So this is why we're in this fight for now for tenants protection. And we want to make sure the good cause is passed. We definitely want some type of protection put in place, because outside of New York City and Westchester County and Long Island, there's no rent stabilization or no type of rent protection for renters. So that's why we're here today. And this is, like I said, he's an owner-occupied landlord, and he has a story.
Thank you.
Hi, thank you for staying all day. I'm going to read something I wrote, that's okay. The Good Cause Eviction Bill, introduced by Julia Salazar and Pamela Hunter, is the right bill for Newburgh. We in Newburgh have a community of property owners that have purchased distressed properties in a multitude of ways, either through the land bank or from the city itself, or various short sale opportunities offered throughout the financial community. We are dedicated property owners, dedicated to the city of Newburgh, that has made these transactions possible. And we are dedicated to people of Newburgh, who are our neighbors, and dedicated to the tenants we help. New boilers, new roofs, upgrades in plumbing and electrical are all par for the course. Taking these hulking pile of bricks and lumber, resuscitating them, cleaning them up, cleaning them of their code violations, getting them back on the tax rolls is a considerable task. This is an investment we need to protect. Good Cause Eviction Bill and enforcing building code laws that are presently already on the books help us protect that investment. There is a business model in Newburgh that is detrimental to all concerns here in Newburgh. We hear of situations where tenants go without heat in the coldest months of the year. We see families living in decay and squalid conditions in buildings routinely flagged for code violations. We hear of tenants getting evicted for pointing out these various unsafe conditions they live in. And while we scrape away the years of neglect and provide clean, safe housing for all of Newburgh residents, there is a group of investors that ignores the building codes and pay the fines, small fines, as a condition of doing business. We need an even playing field, and all landlords must be held to the same standards. Newburgh must hold us all responsible, and enforcement is paramount. This good cause bill is designed to take on the corporate landlords that perpetuate the filth that we must endure. In fact, good cause is actually good for the smaller investors. By slowing the speculation, it will help first-time home buyers compete in the housing market. Thank you.
Danger. Like you said, the firefighters, when they were talking earlier, the phenomenon now in Newburgh is there are a lot of single or two-family homes. These landlords have taken these single-family homes and these two-family homes and have made them into like 20 rooms. So now when these firemen go in there, like they said, you don't know what you're going. You think you're going to a single-family house, and now you got 20 rooms in there, walls that were not in there before, and stuff like that. So I could take you to 10 buildings right now where there were single family homes, and now you got like 30 families living in them in rooms because these landlords have taken these houses and turned them into apartments and turned them into rooming houses. Basically, they have turned them into rooming houses. So how is this being done if code compliance is doing their job? So we need to make sure that these protections are put in place and our code and compliance is doing their job. Because like I said, I know 10 buildings right offhand. In fact, the one that landlord was talking about today, where the car ran into his building or whatever, when they went in there, they found out there was like 20 rooms in there or something like that, in a building that was supposed to be, I guess it was supposed to be like an apartment, like two or three rooms, but it has turned into 20 rooms. So this is what's going on in the city of Newburgh, and this is why we need tenant protection outside of New York City. Thank you. I'm not going to keep you all this because I got 1,000 more stories to tell you about landlords and tenants, but we need landlords need tenants and tenants need landlords. So we like to build that relationship and make sure we fix that relationship first. Thank you.
Thank you. If you could hold up Senator Myrie.
I just wanted to say thank you to both of you for your testimony. Thank you for staying all day. I think a lot of times people forget when we talk about tenant protections and we talk about speculation, the people who have made these communities attractive in the first place are the ones that are bearing the brunt of the crisis right now. And for you, as someone who is a 7th generation Newburgh resident, you should be the one reaping the benefits from staying in this community, not the one being pushed out. And I want to thank you as a property owner for your courage to talk about the need for tenant protections because you don't have the benefit of a large, well-funded organization that gets to send fancy representatives to come to these, but you come as someone who is invested in this community. We heard from a Newburgh landlord earlier today who called his tenants animals. And it was a disgrace. And to have you represent the best of Newburgh and to come forward and to talk about the need for tenant protections is incredibly important. So I just wanted to really thank you for your testimony today.
And also one more known fact. 60, 70, 80% of the renters, at least 75% of their income is paying rent. So we have to change those numbers because when 75% of your income is paying rent, you have no money left over for nothing else, for your children or for anything else. So thank you for listening.
Thank you. So next up, we're going to have the folks from Sullivan Agencies Leading Together, Thomas Bosquet and Martin Colavito. Thank you both.
This is kind of new to me, so you have to forgive me. My name is Martin Calavito, and I am a part of something called Sullivan Agencies Leading Together called SALT. We're a community coalition, probably about a couple of hundred strong in Sullivan County. It's non-funded. So our mission is to compassionately engage people and to remind people that hope is always in the room, and that through a human contact and a human touch, you know, people can not only get service, but turn hopelessness into hopefulness, all right? One of the things, I can tell you stories. I don't need to tell you stories. What I can talk about is systemically what's going on in Sullivan County and how it affects the person who's trying to feed their families. And one of the things that are happening in Sullivan County is that there's we've all heard of this lack of affordable housing, that everybody, it's been a steady thread throughout the time I've been here. And every community is unique, and what makes Sullivan County very unique is that we're above and beyond a rural county. We're a very impoverished county, and we're 61 out of 62 in regard to New York State health indicators. I met my wife in Appalachia in 1979. And was lucky enough to love somebody very dearly since then. And when I was working in Appalachia, and Lynn, my wife, was working in Appalachia, at the time it was probably the most impoverished area in the country. And when Lynn and myself walk around Sullivan County now, it puts us in mind of Appalachia in 1979. Part of that is because, again, systemically, we have an affordable housing crisis, I would say, in Sullivan County. And because of that, the trauma that's inflicted upon people because of lack of housing is systemic in nature. So what landlords can do, possibly do, and there's a lot of good landlords. I want to pray, I've also been a community organizer for 40 years. Right? And so there's a lot of really good landlords, but what happens is that landlords realize, or people realize, who are not operating correctly, that they kind of have an upper hand in regard to code compliance. One of our strong partners in Sullivan County is the county itself and the code compliance officers. But sometimes I go home at night and say to myself, if they do their jobs, who feeds and houses the people who you know, there are no other resources. There is no plan B, right? There is no chance for that person to find even the slightest bit of housing anywhere else in Sullivan County. So there's that dynamic happening in the county that has all of us on our heels, has the county on its heels, who's trying to do the right things, of people who are in the community, you know, because they believe it's an investment, it's their lifelong 401k as opposed to, you know, the things they're getting every week and, you know, as part of their paycheck. You know, I want to invest in my county, I have three grandchildren in my county. So as a result of that, now people in our county are afraid. They're afraid, you know, Amari had said, brought up a really good point in regard to leases. You know, leases are non-existent to a lot of people in Sullivan County. If I ask you for a lease in Sullivan County, you're not going to rent to me, all right? So what's happening, especially in the town of Fallsburg, is that, and this is epidemic in proportion now, because SALT being a volunteer agency, one of the things we do is we have a telephone number that if you call that number today, six phones ring at once, and that's our steering committee. And whoever answers that phone first is charged with navigating that person to service, and not just saying, hey, here, go there, but saying, hey, how can I bring you there? Okay? So one of the things that we're starting to hear in the phone calls we're getting regularly are people who are saying, hey, look, I'm paying $800 a month for rent. My rent is due next week. My landlord just told me I have to pay $1,400 next month, or I'm gone. It's happening all over the place. So I try to navigate them to one of our strong partners, the Legal Services of the Hudson Valley. They're afraid to go. They're afraid to go. They don't know what to do. So their only recourse then, especially people of color and people of color who have been stigmatized because of their status in our country, who helped build our country and now are stigmatized because they had the misfortune of building this country, you know, culturally. Right? These folks now end up living with other people, and then the housing then kind of tumbles and tumbles. It's like a domino effect. So in Sullivan County, as a result of that, there is no hope, okay? We often joke around and say that Sullivan County, we wish as a county we had the resources that Newburgh had as a city, and we'll do fine. You can leave us alone, okay? But the reality of it is we don't. And the reality of it is our major entity in Sullivan County is hopelessness. Is trying to get a single woman who has three children, who is making $24,000 a year because she doesn't want to be on social services, who is living in a place where she's eligible for HEAP, but because of the nozzle on the gas tank, it's not code compliant that the oil companies follow, they will not deliver. So she has to pay for her oil, even though she's eligible for HEAP. You know, these are things that are happening. And it's the thing I fear more than anything is somebody who loves my family and loves my friends and does want to invest in the people that invest in me, is that this is a problem. You know, housing is a problem, and it's fueled by issues. And the issues are the things we need to kind of start talking about as well. And the issues are the things that are going to ultimately solve the problems, because we'll develop goals and meet objectives. But right now, Sullivan County, the average person who's making $30,000 a year or $34,000 a year in Sullivan County is hopeless. The number one employer in Sullivan County is healthcare, all right? Over the past 4 months, I've been doing focus groups and interviewing, key informant interviews with people. And I'm interviewing more and more people who are providing health care to people, substance use disorders, you name it. And what's happening is they're working jobs overnight so they can come and serve during the day, all right? Because they can't afford to pay their rent, they can't afford to feed their families, and the cycle continues to spin. And I don't want to waste your time, Guy, because you've been here all day. But part of the things, I got to be honest with you, part of the thing that breeds hopelessness, and I know there's a reason, and I don't sit in judgment when I say this. But when people in communities come to hearings like this, and I know that I missed the reason why it started late, so please forgive me, right? But when people on your side of the aisle walk out, it's telling. It's telling. And I would beg you to consider that also, because we need you. And we need you to be sitting there. And we need you to take a tour of our community. And we need you to come to a SALT meeting, not because I want people, we're not political, what are you gonna fire me? We're volunteer, all right? But I need you to be socially conscious and open your hearts and minds to what we're going through. And I don't wanna, okay?
Thank you. Remarks, Dan? Okay. So
my stories are anecdotal.
So let me just, there's something called preaching to the choir. So telling folks I used to go to a church on Sunday where the priest would say, you know, and you should go to church. And we were all sitting there saying, we're in church. We appreciate it. But also I would just note that this is the fourth hearing on this topic and the fifth hearing of the Housing Committee during the month of May. And this, I believe, is our 29th hour of taking testimony on this topic. And we have had, you know, we had 14 senators in Albany just yesterday hearing testimony from around the state. So,
I got to tell you, all right, one guy to another, all right? This is my 35th year in Sullivan County, all right? This is my grandchildren are here. My daughter raised here, and if she didn't have a mother and father who loved her, be dead today, all right? So I got to remind you that people talk about gentrification. And I remember sitting in this room, Karen Mahir is a city council person saying to me, what's wrong with gentrification? I said, nothing's wrong with gentrification as long as there's consideration behind it, all right? So trust me when I tell you, I know you guys are doing yeoman's work with this. I'm just telling you about the look, that's all.
I appreciate all that, right? And I just thought I would just note for the record that how many hours many of our senators, you know, including Senator Skoufis, who was here before 9 a.m. and, you know, left 9 hours later. But anyway, I will do folks on the panel have a question?
Thank you.
Have a good day.
Thank you. We really appreciate it.
I want to thank you guys for coming and being here for Sullivan County and talking. I appreciate it.
Okay, we appreciate it very much. Next up, I think, so I'm going to call Angel Estrada, or perhaps Angel Estrada, and Liliana Cobo, both of Make the Road, and I believe there may be translators joining them. Is there anybody else here who is expecting to testify today? Okay, so I believe this will be our last panel, and we appreciate your patience.
Buenas tardes. Buenas tardes. Mi nombre es Liliana Cobo. Estoy aquí para apoyar la buena causa, pues soy una de las 5 millones de personas sin protección del Estado.
Good morning. Today I'm here supporting the good cause legislation because I am one of the 5 million people without protections in the state.
Vivo en la 8 de Eastview Avenue en White Plains, en una casa de 3 apartamentos y el dueño no vive ahí. Entonces, si llegara a pasar esta legislación, por fin tendríamos protección. He vivido en este lugar 10 años y mi hijo, tiene 17 años y mi pareja. Mi hijo ha crecido en esta casa y vecindario.
I live in 8 Eastview Avenue, White Plains, New York. I live in a 3-apartment house and the owner does not live there. So if this regulation were to pass, I would finally have protections. I have lived in this place for 10 years with my 17-year-old son and my partner. My son has grown up in this house and in this neighborhood.
La casa necesita atención, pues tenemos un problema de ratas y cuando aviso al dueño, muchas veces no hace nada. Mi estufa tiene mucho tiempo que no funciona muy bien. No puedo cocinar para mi familia y tengo que gastar más dinero comprando comida afuera. El lavamanos de mi baño tiene moho constante y no se ha reparado en años. He tenido que invertir mucho de mi propio dinero en reparación y aún así estar pagando renta. Lo que me parece injusto, sigo esperando a alguien que venga a arreglar la situación, pero nunca llega nadie.
The house needs work. We have a rat problem, and when I have warned the owner many times before, he doesn't do anything. My stove has not worked properly in a long time, and without this essential appliance, I can't cook for my family and have to spend more money buying food outside. The sink in the bathroom is constantly moldy and has not been repaired in years, although the owner knows about the issue. I've had to invest a lot of my own money in repairs and still be paying rent, which seems unfair. I'm still waiting for someone to come and fix the situation, but nobody ever comes.
Pero como no tengo protección, pues no insisto porque puede ser que el dueño quiere simplemente me saque del apartamento. Y la verdad es muy difícil encontrar lugares donde vivir con los precios tan altos que hay en el área de White Plains y Westchester. Si sigo pidiendo reparación, tal vez pueda quedar hasta sin hogar.
But since I do not have protections, I do not insist because there is a possibility that if the owner wants to, they can simply kick me out of the apartment. And the truth is that it is very difficult to find places to live in with the high prices that exist in the White Plains and the Westchester area. If I keep asking for repairs, I may be homeless.
Este es el riesgo que muchas personas como yo tenemos y seguiremos teniendo si no se pasa la legislación de buena causa. También vemos incremento de renta demasiado grande y muchas familias tienen que desalojar sus viviendas de daño por no poder pagar estos precios.
This is the risk that many people like me have and will continue to have if the good cause legislation is not passed. We also see rent increases that are too high and many families have to vacate places that have been their homes for years because they cannot afford these prices.
Necesitamos que ustedes apoyen los rentadores porque todos merecemos protecciones y un lugar digno de vivir.
We need you to support all renters because we all deserve protections and a decent place to live.
Thank you. Hola, muy buenas tardes. Hoy estoy aquí para compartir mi testimonio en apoyo a la legislación de buena causa. Espero que compartir mi experiencia pueda ayudar a millones de personas que como yo están sin protecciones en el estado.
Today I'm here to share my testimony in support of the good cause legislation. I hope that sharing my experience can help millions of people who, like me, are without protections in the state.
Mi nombre es Ángel Estrada, y estoy viviendo en el 107 Midland Avenue en Porchester, en una casa de 10 familias donde no tenemos protección. He vivido en esta casa durante los últimos 3 años con mi esposa y mi hija de 3 años, quien ha crecido en este lugar.
My name is Ángel Estrada, and I am living in 107 Midland Avenue in Porchester in a 10-family house where we have no protections. I have lived in this house for the last 3 years with my wife and 3-year-old daughter who has grown up in this house.
Las condiciones del apartamento no son ideales y hasta no sanitarias, pues hay una infestación de ratas y cucarachas que se ha salido de control. También faltan de luces en algunas partes de las afueras de la casa, que es peligroso en la noche, pues se dificulta ver uno, se puede caer, y aunque me he quejado con el dueño, él no ha hecho caso del asunto. Tengo miedo en algún día mi hija se enferme o sea mordida por esta plaga. Mucha de nuestra comunidad amanece con hoyos. Mucha de nuestra comida amanece con hoyos y mordiscos de rata y se tiene que tirar, lo que es un gran desperdicio de comida y mucho gasto. Creo que es injusto que esto no ha sido arreglado y tomado en cuenta por el dueño del apartamento, y aún así mi renta se sigue cobrando y sigue subiendo.
The conditions of the apartment are not ideal and even unsanitary, as there is an infestation of rats and cockroaches that has gone out of control. The building is also missing lights in some parts of the outskirts of the house, which is dangerous at night. It is difficult to see and one can fall. And although I have complained to the owner, he has ignored the matter. I'm afraid that one day my daughter will get sick or bitten by this plague. Much of our food shows holes and rat bites in the mornings, and it has to be thrown away. This is a big, big waste of food and money. I think it is unfair that this has not been fixed and taken into account by the owner of the apartment, but my rent is still charged and continues to rise.
Durante estos 3 años que he vivido en el edificio, mi renta ha subido $200 ya una vez, y el dueño me ha dado un aumento más hace unos días de $300. Eso ya es $500 de aumento en solo 3 años. Con lo que gano de mi salario, me es imposible pagar este monto. Y cuando busqué ayuda, después de este último aumento a oficinas del gobierno locales, lo único que pudieron decirme es que no podía hacer nada porque yo no tenía protecciones.
During these 3 years that I have lived in the building, my rent has gone up $200 once, and the owner has given me another increase just a few days ago of $300. That's already a $500 increase in just 3 years. With what I earn from my salary, it is impossible for me to pay this amount. And when I looked for help after this last increase from local government offices, the only thing they could tell me is that I could not do anything because I did not have protections.
Desde que me llegó el aviso del aumento de renta, he estado estresado, sin dormir y no sé qué hacer. He buscado otros lugares, pero los precios de las rentas están inalcanzables. Y si rento otro lugar sin protecciones, se podría volver a repetir esta situación. Todas las personas que rentamos necesitamos protecciones, todos tenemos familias y necesitamos un lugar donde vivir. Muchos de nosotros estamos a un incremento de renta que de quedarnos sin vivienda.
Since I got the notice of the rent increase, I have been stressed, without sleep, and I do not know what to do. I have searched for other places, but the prices of the rent are unattainable. And if I rent another place without protections, this situation could be repeated again. All renters need protections. We all have families and we need a place to live. Many of us are a rent increase away from being homeless.
Si tuviera protecciones, no tendría miedo de estar aquí el día de hoy dando este testimonio o de reportar las condiciones en que se encuentra el edificio.
If I had protections, I would not be afraid to be here today giving this testimony or to report the conditions of the building.
Pedimos protecciones para todos. Somos 5 millones sin protecciones. La propuesta de buena causa nos daría las protecciones necesarias. Por favor, apoye. Gracias.
We ask for protections for all. We are 5 million without protections. The proposal of good cause would give us the necessary protections. Please support and thank you.
Thank you. Questions, comments? Okay, we again greatly appreciate your patience and all of your testimony and you know the courage and the commitment that it takes to being here today. So thank you very, very much.
Okay.
Thank you. And that, and with that, that concludes our testimony today. And unless my colleagues have additional remarks, closing remarks for today's hearing, seeing and hearing none, that adjourns this hearing of the Standing Committee on Housing, Construction, and Community Development, this public hearing on rent regulation and tenant protection legislation. And again, for those watching at home, we have one more hearing. It is Tuesday, the 28th, from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. in Greenburgh, New York. It is likely to be our last hearing on this topic, at least in this legislative season. So we urge folks who might be listening and may be interested in testifying to contact us and join us on that day. And with that, we adjourn. Thank you so much.